soccer right now, but his baseball game has improved a lot this summer. So that's what you're kind of looking for, to see where they're at compared to where they were in the summer. And you know, you write your last follow on them this week, and or maybe if you see him in Jupiter here in a couple weeks, and then kind of gear up for the spring when we break in February.
It's so. I don't know if I'd say it's a downtime of the year for scouting, because it really goes 12 months of the year. But once you get into the spring, April and then May, once you get close to the draft, it gets really wild as far as who are we going to pick. You're getting out and seeing a lot of people at that time of the year, aren't you?
Yeah. So I have Oklahoma, so we'll start down there. There's a showcase in early February, late January, and those kids will start playing February 15th in some inter-squads, and I know up here we start in March, but it's a race, man. I mean, that's, you've got your board set up. You've got your follow list set up. And you're just going to go try and pick off the best players you can, see how they're doing, the guys that you really like at the top. And you're going to hear of names that you haven't heard before that are starting to pop, velocity starting to creep, or guys are hitting some home runs, or they've gotten stronger, they're running better. So it's a dash. And last year, the weather was so bad last year that, you know, in April and May, I think I drove, you know, close to 12,000 miles in those 2 months just trying to track kids down, and, you know, a 3-4 hour drive every day just to see somebody I needed to see it. One more look.
And the draft is such a wild deal, too. I know the story that gets brought up the most here, maybe not now as it was a couple years ago when Albert was in St. Louis, is all these different teams, Royals included, had a chance to pick a kid who played at Maple Woods just up the road here in Kansas City, and Albert Pujols, and all these people passed up on him. And for a 10-year span, he was as good as you can find in the big leagues.
Yeah. You know, I didn't scout Albert at that time. I was in California, but the gentleman that was a big part of taking him is here, Mike Roberts.
Right.
It's like a second father to me. We worked with the Cardinals forever. He scouted me when I was in college. But, you know, Albert was a wild card. He was a guy that had some power, but there was a lot of swing and miss, people saw. And you know, when you're there till the 13th round, there's a lot of, you know, a lot of people aren't sure about you. So, you know, it's all worked out great for Albert, and it was great for the Cardinals when he was there. And, you know, a lot of times guys – what you see now is not who they're going to be in the future. You know, they get stronger and something clicks and they've got great makeup and heart, and the rest is history.
Tom Johnson with you. We'll have Rod Tompkins bring you play-by-play here on WHB-TV. We're joined here in pregame by Steve Gossett. He's one of the scouts for the Mets. And, you know, St. Louis is a prime example of so many people look for. They want to get that big free agent, and those can help from time to time, but maybe the Angels are a cautionary tale for that as well. If you look at the Cardinals now, who are leading the National League Central, I don't know what the exact number is, but I would bet that a good 70 to 80% of their roster is homegrown, and people that have been drafted and brought up within the last 3 to 4 years. They have a lot of no-names on that squad that are just getting the job done.
Right. Well, Matt Fries is, I think, from San Diego. He's a hometown guy, but from San Diego. Pete Cosman, he's an Oklahoma kid. We took him. Second base is Carpenter. I just saw them play last week, and they're as good as any team I've seen all year. They're patient at the plate. They can swing the bat, and it's a lot of homegrown guys. Adams at first base. Obviously, Matt Holliday is not their guy, but John Jay in center field. And trying to think who's playing right field. But, you know, Molina behind the plate, and they're just swinging the bats, and their pitching staff is almost all homegrown other than Adam Wainwright.
What's kind of their secret for their success in this, that other teams are trying to maybe copy what they're doing, and so they can get to that level sooner than later?
Well, I think we're more conventional scouting staff when I was there, which wasn't long ago, and we took guys with tools. You know, there's a mix of some stats in there, but we took guys that showed that they could hit, and you thought that they would hit down the road. They might not have been as fleet of foot, but you knew the bat was going to play, and they could defend okay. And as far as arms, you always want arm strength, and they have some young kids really step up. Trevor Rosenthal, for one, who's at Cowley County just, you know, 5 years ago, and that's a kid that, you know, his makeup, he turned the corner. A light bulb went on, he turned the corner, he got in shape, and the arm was always there, the breaking ball was there, and now he's refined it all. And
it's not all about throwing 98 either.
No.
At big league level anyway.
But no, they've got a guy out of the bullpen that pitches every night, dang it. I can't remember his name, but, you know, he's not 90, 91, he's 86, 88, but he gets outs. So.
It's Edward Ujica, I think it is.
Him too.
Closer.
He's 88 tonight, you know. So.
Exactly. Let's pause here for the national anthem on WHB-TV.
Can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight?
Of the national anthem here at Community Amira Ballpark. Is this your first time in this park, Steve? This is a wonderful little ballpark for the minor league level.
No, I've been here a number of times. I've scouted some free agents that were playing in here, and it's a great ballpark. Beautiful day. Holy cow.
Exactly. Before we let you go, because we got to let Rod come in here and do the play-by-play here on WHB-TV, the big story with the Mets going to the offseason will be Matt Harvey, who you mentioned a little bit earlier, and yeah, he has an arm problem right now, so they're trying to decide between rest or Tommy John surgery. That has to be a very, very difficult decision considering how important he is.
Yeah, and I just read recently where he's chosen rehab. Mm-hmm. So obviously he's got some really good information that leads him to believe he can get back and be healthy. And you're always, you know, leery of surgery. But Tommy John, most of those guys come back. That's a high percentage of guys that come back from that, and some even stronger. So,
and there, I think you have another two pitcher, I don't know, certainly on the staff, but a young man named Zach Wheeler, if I remember right, who's a stud.
Correct. He came over in the Carlos Beltran trade, and he's done a great job, too.
He was good talent in return. Sounds like you did that.
Yeah.
Steve Gossett of the New York Mets will let you get down to the field here and do your thing with the scouting and enjoy the game.
I appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
Thank you much. We will get Rod Tompkins in here. He's getting ready feverishly behind me, writing down starting lineups, both sides, starting pitchers, all that good stuff. He's good to go. Thank you, Steve. We have, I was calling him off the air. Officially, it's the Navy team against the Columbia team. If you're watching at home, and obviously, if you're doing this, we're so used to being on the radio with a lot of these things, you will be watching at home. It almost looks like, we'll talk about Rod with this a little bit, you'll use a little rivalry here from Tobacco Road. You have one team wearing North Carolina blue, and you have the other team wearing the Navy Duke blue. So it almost looks like that light blue, dark blue sort of thing. Officially, they're calling it Navy against Columbia. Columbia not being Columbia University or Columbia, Missouri, or the country of Columbia, but rather just the simple color of Columbia. Let's go through a few of the players here. We will give you the rosters, and then we'll get to the starting lineups here with my colleague, Rod Tompkins. Shane Bennis is out of Westminster Christian Academy. He's 6'2", 195-pound shortstop for the Navy team. Expect to hear his name a lot through today. He's going to play in the SEC. He is a commit with the University of Missouri with head coach Tim Jamison. Also, Jack Benninghoff. He'll hit the 9-hole. He's out of Rockhurst High School here in Kansas City and a Arkansas Razorback commitment. Clayton Custer, he will play basketball. Boy, smart young man, too. 25 on the ACT, 3.7 GPA. He's going to play basketball in the Big 12. He's out of Blue Valley Northwest. Clayton with the Iowa State Cyclones. Leading off for the Columbia squad here is number 6, Ryan Watkins. And sitting down right in time for the first pitch. I can't say he's late because he's on time by about 2 seconds. My friend and my colleague, Rod Tompkins. Hello, Rod.
Hey, Tom. How you doing, bud? Good to see you. And we both made it. Traffic got you a little bit from what I understand. And a nice interview there with the scout from the Mets. And a lot of guys out here that those Mets are taking a look at. That ball grounded out to third base. And going to be a pretty easy play. But the throw, Aaron, that's going to be E5. Headed on down to second base. Close play there. And he's gunned down.
That took, you got a good chance to watch that one. That took a heck of a bounce off of the sidewall here down the first baseline, and it was that deflection that allowed the Navy squad to throw out the young man at second, but an early error, and I saw a little bit of that. I think there's some rustiness that we're going to see from these young men out here today because it's been a while since they played some baseball.
Got a tough sky right now for the first baseman where the sun's at and everything like that as well. Had a little bit of a tough time with that throw. Did he get him, did I have this correct, 9-6 at second base? Is that who got him? I believe the right fielder's the one that came in and made that throw and got him out.
I thought that deflected back to the first base.
It may have. Like I said, I was sitting down at that particular time, but I know the right fielder in there, that pitch on the way. It's a fastball that's lined out towards right field. And the sun definitely affecting the right side of the infield here. That a ball that should have been caught. They had him played exceedingly deep, but certainly enough time to get underneath that one.
That right fielder out there, Benninghoff, he moved back on the baseball, and that was just a little Texas League shot out there in front of him. The ball was kind of hit off the trademark, and he didn't read that ball well at all. I don't know if he ever saw it off the bat.
I'm not sure either. It's certainly reacted late to it. That a Hawklet from Rockhurst High School out there in right field in Jack Benninghoff.
They got some players that have gone to that school traditionally.
Absolutely, and it doesn't matter whether it's a basketball court on the football field for Tony Severino or whatever the case is, they get a lot of talented athletes there. Lyon, his next pitch on the way, that's going to be a fastball that misses just outside. Again, good to broadcast with you. We did a little show on 810 WHB TV there last weekend, a summary of high school football, mainly up in north central Missouri and here around the metropolitan Kansas City area. So that throw over to first to no avail, just a kind of a reminder that the pitcher's over there. In a game like this, they're out here trying to show off for the scouts. They certainly don't want to get a reputation for being a guy who can't hold runners and things like that.
Well, and when you're showing off for the scouts too, trying to get that minor league contract and get that start is probably more important than winning the whole game.
Absolutely, and plenty of pro scouts out here. I'm sure a fair sum of college scouts out here as well. And that pitch on the way, that good look at Heater right down Broadway.
Well, I mentioned a couple of these guys on the Navy squad. Shane Bennis, University of Missouri. Jack Benninghoff, University of Arkansas. You don't think that's going to be a pretty big rivalry in all these different sports, being the border, the new border war?
And that is two strong baseball schools. Certainly, Missouri really picked up the pace 10 years ago or so, whenever the program really got...
Slider in the dirt there. It was knocked down by the catcher, but a pretty good read by the player at first as he's able to slide in well ahead of the tag. And that's something that scouts will take notice of when you're able to have that nice break with the ball that didn't get very far away from the catcher.
Right, exactly. Most important thing, first thing they do at any tryout, they're going to put them out there. They're going to run 60s. They're going to run foul line to foul line. Slow guys, they're going to go home typically unless they're a pitcher or a catcher. And that's just kind of the way things go. Sometimes that takes for guys like, so we'll say a Billy Butler, somebody like that who could just absolutely kill the ball. Sometimes it takes a little longer to get noticed because of his lack of speed, but certainly once he steps in the batter's box, people take notice. But
there have been a lot of slow, fat guys that have been able to rake in Major League Baseball. You can go back to Babe Ruth for that one.
Well, I always thought he ran pretty good, and I love to watch the videos of his little legs and his big body and how fast he could make a move. It was a lot of fun to watch. That one misses high and away. It looked like a breaking ball to me.
It did, and it didn't have a lot of speed behind it, that's for sure. And it looks like the starting pitcher here is having a little bit of trouble finding the zone for the Navy squad on the top of the first inning. Didn't get a lot of help from his right fielder in that little bloop shot. Should have been caught about 90% of the time, but I think he got caught in the setting sun here off to the west.
Runners at first and second, one away in a, what I now understand to be, 12-inning affair that we've got here today.
We get paid extra for 12 innings.
Sure, if we'll have to take it out of the manager at WHB-TV, Jim Bly's salary, if we get hurt too much by it. So
Jim informed us it was a 12-inning game about 10 minutes before this baby got started. So.
Right, which was about 10 minutes before he wanted to inform us of it, but let us know nonetheless.
Kind of the by-the-way sort of conversation.
Fastball missed outside. The rare snap throw down to second base makes for a pretty close play.
Pretty good arm shown by Nick Perkins. He is a University of Mississippi signee.
He did show that throw right on the money. That's just tough. A guy's got quite a bit of time to retreat to second unless he really gets caught leaning the wrong way. He's going to make it back more times than not. But, again, maybe showcasing that cannon of a right arm that Perkins definitely exists. Doesn't need to showcase it that much more. He's already got his college destination, like you said, picked out.
That's true. He's just trying to make sure that he comes out here and performs well.
That ball lined up the middle. Oh diving catch, double play.
Awesome.
That's going to be the 6-4 double play. The liner gloved by the shortstop up to the second baseman. And very, very nice play there. That ends the inning. And between our two squads here, we've got the Navy. Who else do we have, Jen?
We have Tom. It looks like we have the U.S. Naval Academy against Columbia University, but that's not really the case.
Okay.
Yeah, because it says Navy team against Columbia team. I said before you got on the air, it kind of looks like Duke against North Carolina with the Carolina blue and the Duke kind of Navy blue.
Right. Those colors could certainly get any kind of rivalry going, especially between those two that you mentioned, but... It was interesting. Was that Steve Johnson, I believe it was, you were talking to earlier? Is that
Steve
was
Gossett.
Okay, I apologize. I just kind of caught that on the way in. But interesting, was talking to him. You know, we have all these Kansas City area products. We got a lot of kids out here from some small schools, kind of some guys that I'm familiar with. A pitcher on the Navy team, a right-hander out of the lovely town of Alma, Missouri, Santa Fe High School. Good friend of mine, Josh Fisher, the head coach there. I don't know if he's the friend of a lot of other Class 1 baseball coaches. About since I've known him, about 6 trips to the Final Four, at least 2 state titles, maybe 3. And Keaton Graff, the right-hander for him, is a kid who's pretty impressive. As I talked to Steve Gossett there earlier, he was telling me Keaton already a 90-plus kid. I believe he said he'd seen him as high as 93 or 94, I believe he said. And coming out of Class 1 Missouri baseball, that's pretty impressive. We don't see a lot of kids with those type of arms.
I tell you what. You were talking about his arm. I'm looking at how smart these kids are. Look at some of these ACT scores and the GPAs. There's not a single GPA. Well, I guess I found one. We won't mention who it is with the GPA below 3. But I tell you what, 3.95, 3.88. I saw one.
I saw a 30. There's a 32 on the ACT. Yeah, now that's I know that's much. That's significantly better than I can do on it.
In order for you, if you added yours and I's, we might get close to 30.
Yeah, we might get relatively close. Maybe you could carry me through the math, and I might be able to carry it in another category. But you're right, and this is, as you see the logo for this Get Hits All-Star game, the part of the logo, the graduation cap, the kind of a academic flair that is thrown towards this baseball game, and you see it, like you said, with the college entrance scores, the GPAs and everything like that, and we're just about ready to go again here. I was not the beneficiary of both lineups here prior to this game, I will say. The fault of somebody, I don't know who it was, but it's nobody that I know.
I was the beneficiary of one and waiting for the other.
And
so I'm Navy good and Columbia slow.
That's where I'm at as well. So we're going to try to figure this out as we go along.
Well, I'll tell you what, I will get the Columbia lineup out and we'll start to give some credit to some of these guys in the Columbia blue.
That would be incredible. And 1-1 the count now.
Lineup's right there if you want to go through those.
All lines. Right, I'm going to run through that.
There you go.
Breaking ball. That one misses high and in.
This is what's known as broadcasting on the fly.
Indeed it is. I'm going to let you carry us through a little bit of the play-by-play there, Tom. Tom Johnson going to take it away here for a minute. I'm going to get things a little bit more in order when it comes to the lineups. And we got 12 innings. We might have it right by the end of that.
Yeah, we'll see what we can do. Shawnee Mission South High School right-handed hitter at the plate right now is Austin Gianola, 5'11", 140-pound shortstop, right-handed hitter. Here comes the fastball, and it darts the outside corner for strike 3 from the starting pitcher from the Columbia squad, Austin Knight. He's out of Lebanon, Missouri, and played for the Kansas City Elite squad. 3.0 GPA for that young man, as he just threw a fireball on the outside corner for the first out. Now stepping in for the Navy team is number 2, Elijah Dilday. He is out of Francis Howell. I believe that's in the St. Louis area. Right fielder, 6 feet 1 inches tall, 195 pounds. You kind of freak out there for a second when about a 2.5-second span there. I didn't have a number 2 on my roster. They have the rosters in alphabetical order, last name, but not in numerical order.
That'd only be the probably second or third time that's happened to you this week, wouldn't it?
More than that.
Exactly. We know how this goes.
Straight up and down stance in the left-handed batter's box. That pitch is a low from Austin Knight. Dug out of the dirt nicely, and the count is 1-1. No score here from Community America Ballpark in KCK. Wonderful facility here around the NASCAR track. There's a line drive in right center field coming over and making the catch with the sun in his eyes. Almost catching that one right between the eyes was the right fielder for Columbia.
May have been a last-second decision and just catching that ball at the right time. He had a good jump on it. Obviously saw it off the bat, lost it about midway there, and it got on top of him pretty quick. His instincts carry him over there, and he makes a a nice grab at the end. That's going to be tough, I'd say, for at least another half hour probably.
It looked like to the naked eye that he got his glove up there in front of his face to protect his face, and the ball happened to hit his glove.
Something like that. That's where I was going with that.
A self-preservation catch out in right field on a ball that was hard struck.
Kyle Reed at the plate, the left fielder. That pitch misses high and away.
This is a beautiful ballpark. This is my first time being in the ballpark. I've been by it many times. I like the little nooks and crannies that they put into this ballpark here, just off to the west of Sporting Park.
Right next to the Kansas Speedway as well, and it's a beautiful area, and this is certainly a part of the Kansas City metropolitan area that is booming at this juncture. Two out now, 3-0 count to the hitter, Kyle Reed.
I like the big smokestack out there beyond right center field with the Dave and Buster sign on it.
I like that as well.
Very nice, very nice. Looks baseball-like.
This has got an old-time feel to it, old school and old-time feel, and I love that. I love places like Phil Welch Stadium in St. Joe. That's a great place to go for baseball. And
Phil Welch is a big park if you've never been there, though. And this park, especially to left field, if you pull the ball to left, some of these right-handed hitters, you can yank it over. Looks like about a 20, 25-foot high fence.
It is, definitely. And obviously, we all have plenty of these kids that are capable of doing that. As I take a look out here, I believe we're using all wood bats today, it looks like, as well.
Now, you know, the kids are used to aluminum, but if they're going to play at the next level, you better start learning how to use the wood.
Right, I like home runs, but I'd kind of like to see them take them away altogether. Of course, there's some companies like DeMarini and Easton, companies like that, don't really want to hear me say that.
Well, and the whole bat issue in college baseball, anyway, has been a huge issue over the last 5 years, and runs have literally gone from through the roof in college baseball, and now they're complaining at the College World Series that there aren't enough runs and home runs.
I'd assume the BB cores, which are pop-wise very similar to these wooden bats, the steal of second base right there by
Kyle Reed. He's out of Blue Springs, so he's playing close to home, just on the other side of the border, and that's another program that produces its good share of athletes. And you know, as far as football goes, I know K-State, Missouri, they kind of have some battles going over there in Blue Springs. There's some of that talent either going east or west.
Well, there's no doubt about that. A stretch, the pitch, fastball. Misses just off the outside edge with it.
Looks like both starting pitchers here, they're trying to find the plate a little bit. They're trying to find that good pinpoint control that I'm sure both have when they're on.
Absolutely. I'll tell you one thing, as I noticed, I looked over the rosters for this game. That a breaking ball that failed to break, and it missed up and in. Did he get a piece of him as well?
I don't know. It bent his back pretty well. As old as you and I are, Rod, we do that to our back, and we're in traction.
Right, exactly.
That came up in. That gave Brad Archer out of Lebanon, Missouri, a pretty close shave. He played for the Midwest Nationals here over the summer.
And that a good team, a great Ben Johnson area league here for these kids to play in. All-stars out here, put it on the line, trying to get to that next level, whether it be college or professional baseball. And we've got some impressive young athletes out here. That pitch a called strike.
It's 325 down the right field line here at Community America Ballpark, and it goes all the way to 409 in deep right center. From Major League, that is a heater right there.
Yes, it was. Popping the mitt. And these kids, that's one thing you'll notice. We'll hear some of them who are able to do that, and we'll hear some who aren't.
Forget the curveball, Ricky. Throw them the heater.
That's right.
Great movie line.
Don't throw. That's the Terminator, I believe, wasn't it?
That's the see you later.
There's all kinds of names for it during that one particular time, and a few of them we can't even mention on the air.
Bob Uecker's one of the best, though. Harry Doyle.
Dynamite drop in, Monty.
he's not the best paid color analyst in the world for nothing, is he?
He's pretty entertaining. I tell you what, there's an awful lot of guys who I know you've got a lot of respect for, and I do too, all around the major leagues. John Miller, one of my favorites. I love to listen to that guy.
Yeah, smooth delivery.
And exceptionally intelligent, all of them are, but that ball popped up right side, out of play, well back, and onto the roof.
Nobody's better at this than Vin Scully, though, the guy in L.A.
Oh, no question. I agree 100. I'm very fond of Miller, but Vin Scully would be another one. Want to take in a game at Chavez Ravine one of these days. Never have. I know you've been to a lot of parks around the country.
I haven't been to California. I haven't been to the Northeast. As I was telling Steve, I haven't been up to the – I've been to Baltimore and Washington, but not the new park in Philly, both New York's or Boston. It costs more. It's amazing how it works. It costs more to travel those big cities on the coast.
It sure does. Either one of them.
It costs more to go east than west. I don't know why that is, but maybe for some reason we can find out why. From some of the different airlines across the country. Boy, was that a nice looking hook. It froze the batter at home plate, and that was a dandy. Looked like overhand curveball, the 12-6 variety there from Columbia.
And not a lot of kids we're going to be able to, or that we'll see that we'll be able to throw that 12-6. A lot more slurve type actions than we'll see in that up and down or 12-6 curveball. But we'll see a few of them. That was a good one right there. Rod Tompkins, Tom Johnson.
Well, the young man who just threw that 12-6 hook is Austin Knight. We mentioned his name a couple of times, and he's a signee of Missouri State. So he's going to be playing his ball with the Bears down in Springfield.
They're putting together a nice baseball program at Lebanon, Missouri, I believe you said he was from, correct?
Correct.
And strong area athletics around there in the Lebanon area as well. Tom and I, we're going to take a quick little break. We'll come back with the next inning of play. No score here in this Get Hits All-Star game. From Community America Ballpark in Kansas City, Kansas. Back with more right after this here on 810 WHB-TV. Mason O'Brien leads things off here at the top half of the second inning and takes that one down and in. Tom, you are telling me this young man's got some pretty...
some Okie blood.
Yeah, some Okie blood, and going to keep it right there in state, isn't he?
Why not? Yeah, it's Oklahoma State. It's a pretty good baseball program. I think if memory serves me okay, I think the White Sox manager, Robin Ventura, is probably the best of all the Oklahoma State grads over the years. And I'm probably missing somebody obvious, but Ventura is pretty good.
Pete Incaviglia.
There's a good one.
Not as good as Robin Ventura, but a big home run hitter.
We're both showing our age with that mention, but at least we're not going 50s and 60s.
Right. Both played together, I would assume, there at some juncture. They were close enough to the same age.
Mid-80s, late 80s, you bet.
Of course, Robin Ventura still holding on to his job there with the White Sox, isn't he? Barely.
Wow. That's a town that hasn't had good baseball this year between the Cubs and the White Sox. It's also a town that I talked to the Mets scout, Steve, that was up here earlier, and you don't lose in New York without getting some heat, and Chicago's the same way.
Chicago, Philly. You could probably win in Philly and still be in some kind of trouble.
You know what, though? The Royals have gone through umpteen losing seasons in a row. By the way, since they won today 4-0 on that grand slam in the bottom of the 10th, that secured a winning season. So no longer losers, Kansas City. You got a winning baseball team this year, no matter what happens over the next week playoff-wise.
That is right. The change of pace right there gets Mason O'Brien. Change up and
Lang is the pitcher out there now for the Navy squad, number 18. He's out of Lee's Summit West. 6'3", 210-pounder. Big, burly right-hander for Navy.
Burley might be a little bit of a stretch.
If you're over 200 in my line, you're burly.
Oh, well, I must be very burly then.
Now, you're burly at his age if you're over 200. At our age, you don't eat well, myself included.
A little breaking ball there that missed down and in, or inside at least anyway. We are in a great position here at Community America Ballpark to call this game. Not a fastball, and right about, the bottom of his thigh, I would say, as far as height goes. Probably a pitch that was up a little more than the pitcher wanted. Made up for it there, though, as he came back with a breaking ball that the hitter just waved at and missed.
T.J. Martin is the hitter. He's out Overland Park, Blue Valley Southwest. Played for Building Champions this summer, and he's a future KU Jayhawk, so he's going to keep it pretty close to home.
Next one on the way. Again, the breaking ball, and this one swung at and missed.
Look at that. We got a roster for you.
We indeed.
We have the roster. We just need the order of the lineup.
The order of the lineup. Right now was O'Brien, then Martin. This is going to be Wahlberg coming to the plate. Quentin Wahlberg out of Edmond, Oklahoma.
It's Wahlberg with an H. W-A-L-B-E-R-G-H. He's going to be a Texas Tech Red Raider. We mentioned the amount of smarts on the field today. Young Mr. Wahlberg, his GPA is 3.95.
Quentin, got to play baseball, doesn't need to.
What happened to that .05? That's what I'd ask him.
Right.
You're that close.
Probably was that good, probably just didn't want to brag too much.
I got to the point in my senior year, I just wanted to get my degree. You kind of get to that point of saying, as long as I pass the class, I'm good.
Yeah, I made it out of there. Mine was, my GPA was good. Or decent. Could have been a lot better.
I was told they kicked you out kicking and screaming.
Well, that might have been the case, too. I went on the way. Fastball catches the inside corner. Home plate umpire had to think about that one just a second. Must have been a pretty close pitch.
Beautiful night for baseball here in KCK. There's not a cloud in the sky, and temperatures right around 70, 75 degrees here at first pitch. There is a nice-looking slider that had the batter for Columbia out in his right foot. Quinton Wahlberg waves at it for strike three. That was a good-looking ending there for Navy.
Without question, it was. And the hitters yet to catch up with the pitchers here in this one. No score after an inning and a half between these two teams at the Get Hits All-Star Game, Community America Ballpark, Kansas City, Kansas. Rod Tompkins, Tom Johnson, 1.5 in the books. We'll be back with the bottom half of the second. We'll do that next right here on 810 WHB-TV.
I'll keep my eye open. Thank you. this would definitely fit. It's a big, strong right-handed batter from Francis Howell High School. Nick Perkins, the batter for the Navy team. He is 6'4", 210 catcher, and a 2014 grad out of Francis Howell, so he's in his senior year. And I noticed him behind the plate for the Navy team. He's just a guy, he looks like a catcher. Big, strong, kind of that Joe Mauer with Minnesota Twins type.
How'd I know you were going to come with one of the Twins there?
I had to.
Some might pick up on your accent a little bit. Not too much these days, but Joe Mauer, you certainly can never go wrong picking Joe Mauer. I'd like to see him a little healthier. Actually, being a Royals fan, I'm not sure I'd like to see him a little healthier, but certainly for his own well-being, that's going to be a walk issue there to Nick Perkins. It'll bring up a young man from, I believe, down in the Boot Hill, isn't he, in Kevonte Mitchell, I believe, Kennett High School. Is that correct?
That would be Boot Hill as far as I'm concerned. That's a long way from home. That's a healthy, healthy weekend trip for the young man coming up to KCK.
That's absolutely right. Boy, he's an impressive-looking athlete. You can just look at him, and his makeup and his build screams baseball.
Lean physique, right-handed hitter. You know, with that number 27, he kind of looks like the hero of the Royals game today, Mr. Justin Maxwell.
And hero he was, and certainly got to give him the credit. Big Game James was the man.
I tell you what, as I said about the Royals, no matter what happens over the next week, how about your last regular season home game and you win it on a 3-2, two-out grand slam in the bottom of the 10th?
You can't beat it. Like you said, you were listening on the way in, I know you'd said, and that was a kind of a goosebump moment for you there. Had I been listening, it would have been the same thing for me. I didn't catch it until afterwards. I did catch Ryan Lefebvre's call of it, though, and it was tremendous.
Yep. Ooh.
Kevonte Mitchell, big hack, comes up empty, goes down on strikes.
That's called high heats and not catching up to the high heat. When you get the elevated fastball, very, very tough to get on top of that pitch, and that's why you want to lay off that one.
That would be the high cheddar.
This is Taylor Sanagorski out of Bishop Carroll High School.
What city's that in?
Well, I'm looking for it. I have two different rosters here.
Okay.
So we got Bishop Carroll and Mr. Sanagorski. That's Wichita.
Wichita. That's what I thought, but I was not sure. I can't take credit for it. That one swung at and missed by Sanagorski. And
his GPA is north of 4. It's 4.05.
Wow.
I'd like to know how to get the GPA north of 4.
I'd like to know how to get it near 4.
There's a time I'd like to get it up near 3. I'd feel proud of myself.
True enough. 2-1 the count, a runner down at first base, the walk issued to Nick Perkins. That a fastball probably out of the zone, it sure looked like for me, that Sanagorski elected to take a hack at and maybe trying to go down the left field line with it, about the only thing he could have been looking to do right there.
You wonder what the hitters are thinking here in an all-star game, whether or not they want to show patience, or they're probably up there, which is the point I was going to make. You know, hacking at everything they see, so maybe that patience that they'd show in more of a regular season instead of an all-star game might not quite be there today.
That is very possible, and what that's going to do is going to make our pitchers that are out here look even better than they are.
Yeah, and the pitcher here, he just keeps on going further and further outside and getting a swing and a miss there on the heater. So the pitchers are taking advantage of, I think, a little bit of over-aggressiveness from the hitters in this all-star game.
And that's exactly what I was kind of getting ready to touch on there. But there's guys that I'm sure of both approaches out here, depending on how they've been coached or what they feel their biggest strength is. Scouts here that are, going to look for, different qualities in kids. And, you know, we may have scouts out here that, love that kid that shows a lot of patience, a lot of discipline at the plate. And certainly we aren't going to find any coaches that don't love a kid who hits home runs.
I kind of like to see somebody bang it off of that Community America Credit Union side off that big Fenway Park-looking left field wall. I guarantee you, though, that wall is probably about half the size of the Green Monster out in Boston. But it's we can't see how long it is down the left field line, but it's a very reachable 352 to straightaway left. And then there's a little notch that comes in there to 347. Then it veers out to 411 in deepest left center. So that's a quirky wall out there to be playing.
I'll tell you what, got these guys in the outfield. It'll keep them guessing. I'm sure some of these players have played here before. Would be my guess. A 2-1 count.
I've never seen as short as 347 to straightaway left, though. That is a very, very reachable number.
Oh, no question about it. You'll see balls hit there with regularity by the kids with this talent. You'll see a ball given a ride there. That's not going to be out of most parks. That 347. Of course, there's not a very big area where it's that shallow. But certainly, if they happen to give the ball on the right line, it's going to get out of here pretty easily, especially for kids hitting from the right-hand side.
And if you're heading from the left-hand side, I mentioned it goes from 325 to 409 from the right field line to the right center field alley, but it's only about a five-foot-high wall out there.
It is much lower. Some nice green area there behind it. And I tell you what, like you'd said before, this is a quality ballpark. Down on strikes there. So far, a pitcher's game here in this one. The big bats haven't been on display yet. We've got a lot of baseball left, though.
You know what they say, good pitching beats good hitting, and we've seen that for a couple innings.
We have, and what a pitcher's duel. We can't talk enough about that Royals game. Extra inning game, grand slam home run, walk-off by Justin Maxwell to end it. But true pitcher's duel there. You know, I see a lot of 2-1s or 3-2s, but that one's 0-0 through nine innings, and that's awful impressive stuff right there. I love good pitching. The defense part is okay, but good pitching or home run hitting, those are the two things I love, and when you get one, you don't see many of the other.
I might as well bring up my homeland where I grew up for 24 years of my life, because the 0-0 score, whenever a 0-0 game goes extra innings, I think at Game 7 in the 91 series, the Jack Morris game, which if that would have ended on a grand slam bottom of the 10th, that would have been the greatest moment in baseball history as far as I'm concerned, but it ended on a long fly ball at the infield in. But you know, that was a great World Series, the 2001 Yankees Diamondbacks, great World Series, and I hope we can just get a playoff game at Kauffman Stadium here in the next couple of years, if not this year.
Anytime. 3.5 back, it's going to be tough with 7 to go.
Would have been nice to not have the Astros lay down like dogs over the last four games in Cleveland.
They've been laying down most of the season, however. Yeah. Best thing they did, gave us Justin Maxwell, of course.
Yeah. What's, I think their record's 51-104. That's even the Royals' worst years, going back about 5 years, they lost 106. I think Houston's going to demolish that record. They're going for 110.
And we may see them right back in contention 2 years from now, too. You know, a lot of times you see turnarounds almost overnight. Of course, the team known most for it, the Miami Marlins. They bring them in, they win, they sell them off, and then they do it again.
Well, look, at Washington, their first few years after moving from Montreal, the Nationals were a terrible team with not a lot of, you know, interest in the fan base, kind of in a Redskins town. All of a sudden, they're terrible. They get back-to-back number ones pick. They get a guy named Strasburg. They get a guy named Harper. Get a couple of free agents to come into a big market.
Jason Worth, guys like that.
They've been rolling pretty well. And you got to do it a little bit different if you're looking at the Royals, kind of getting back to that discussion we've been having. But who knows? Yep. They got, I thought it was 6 games on the road, but maybe it's 7. I know they go to Seattle and then Chicago. It might be 7 games. Win them all and see where you can get them.
And it's going to be tough. The schedule for the
Cleveland is poor.
I think Tampa's schedule pretty easy, too, the rest of the way. Good to see them beating a good team like the Texas Rangers, though. They, you know, even with the departure of a lot of talent there, they still got a ton. That Yu Darvish, I've never seen him pitch in person. I'd sure like to, though. That guy's pretty impressive.
He has kind of the variety of pitches. He's kind of the jack of all trades. I think he can throw 95, and he can also throw that 65-mile-per-hour really slow Ephus pitch.
That sounds a little like Zach Greinke to me.
Just a tad. That might be the team that wins it all, the Dodgers, with the pitching they have.
No doubt, Clayton Kershaw, Zach Greinke, and I tell you what, when it comes down to the Cy Young, it's going to get decided by that team.
Yep, I agree with you.
Greinke, last time I checked, 15-3.
That was nasty. That was a nasty pitch.
That, of course, was a off-speed pitch. I wouldn't guarantee it to be a changeup. It had a funny look to it, almost a knuckleball type look to it.
Zach Engelken, local kid out of Overland Park and Blue Valley West, and he's going to play in the Big Ten with the University of Nebraska.
We have a drop third strike and then a drop throw by the first baseman.
It's a good throw, too. Sandergowski had the ball maybe a little bit to the second base side of the first base bag, kind of reaching in there, but a very catchable ball. Just had it deflect off his mitt. I don't think the sun was in his eyes because that went from shade to shade. So I think that was just a plain old error down there at first base after the strikeout.
Right, and the sun kind of gone for the infielders now, with the exception of a little bit of an area right where the shortstop's standing at this particular time. The outfielders, all three of them still out in the bright sun. That pitch, fastball that missed, I'm just not sure where.
Low, as if I had to guess, because it looked like it shaved the outside corner.
Beautiful Community America Ballpark in Kansas City, Kansas. Rod Tompkins and Tom Johnson here with the Get Hits All-Star Game. A lot of impressive athletes.
That was in on the hands. You don't see many balls that are fouled by a right-handed hitter directly over the third base bag. That's when you know you got it in on your kitchen, and he's taking that piece of lumber and he's tossing it back to the dugout. I think that's a broken piece of lumber.
It was. I caught that sound, and then I saw him striding over there, and I'll tell you what, as the pitcher, you got to smile anytime you break a guy's bat.
Oh, you know that the guy's hands, too, they just got to be roaring right now. And when you foul one off like that over your ear flap and your hands just after you break a bat on a pitch that far in, they just got to be yelling at you.
We'll pick off, move over to first base, and not a super close play, but enough to get your attention at least anyway. Still back with a nice lead over there at first.
Known as in the biz is keeping you honest. Now the runner's on the move.
Swung out and missed. Throw down to second. Pretty good, but not in time. The jump got him there.
He did get that good jump. The pitcher for the Navy team right now is number 33, Zach Engelken. We just mentioned him. He's out of Blue Valley West. 3.1 GPA for the young man. 23 on the ACT score. And he's a future Nebraska Cornhusker. Going to head up I-29 up to Lincoln.
We'll try not to hold that against him.
Yeah.
It'll be difficult, though. You being the Gopher fan that you are. And
I know. Well, I grew up a Gopher fan, moved to Kansas and Missouri, kind of became a Missouri Tiger fan as I moved to Missouri about 10 years ago. And now my general dislike of Nebraska has gone from a Missouri hate to a Minnesota hate.
Wow, you get the combination there. That may make for more hatred than the average person.
It would have been awkward for me. There were so many rumors going back a couple of years that Missouri is going to get the spot in the Big Ten that Nebraska ended up getting. And I was like, I don't know if I want the Tigers and the Gophers playing anytime soon. That'd be awkward. Sound effects here are kind of weird, aren't they?
That was a little bit different right there. Had nothing I'd ever heard before.
Random cheering.
Breaking ball misses up high.
Taking the walk there for the Columbia team is number 11, Tanner Gregg. He's probably one of the guys that is being looked at most closely, especially by colleges. He's undecided right now out of Blue Valley West High School in Overland Park. He played for the East Cobb Braves. I wonder if that's in Georgia here over the summer. Cobb County's in Georgia, and the Braves are a Georgia team. So.
Well, true, so it could be.
And I'm sure not familiar with the East Cobb Braves off the top of my head.
1-0 the count, no score here in this game. Our first real threat here.
Kind of be like if somebody were playing for the Jackson County Royals, it would kind of tip me off that sounds like a Kansas City area squad.
I agree with you. I pitch a called strike.
The batter is Griffin Robinson. We know he's from the Kansas City Barnstormers by way of Shawnee Mission Northwest.
Barnstormers, a nice band Johnson team from here in the area. We've had some area kids that have played on those teams. We've had kids from the Chillicothe and other areas up in north Missouri that have came down to play. Tanner Baker, former Meadville Eagle point guard, a kid who you're familiar with.
Absolutely. Oh, that's right in on the fist. Ouch.
That's going to be awful close to a base hit, too. In fact, he is safe.
Getting over there a little bit slow was the pitcher here for Navy squad, Zach Engelken. That was a hard play to field. It was right in on the fists, and that almost worked like a little slap bunt would from a left-handed hitter, where it doesn't get high enough in the air for the pitcher to grab it, the first baseman to grab it, the second baseman to grab it. It sat there and it spun and it landed between all three. The first baseman picked it up, and I think just from the confusion, not playing with each other a long time, Engelken, what he looked like he was halfway between trying to go for the ball and going for the base, and he got caught in between.
He sure did, and I knew it was trouble off the bat, and it sounded like it broke his bat, actually, too, again.
It sounded like it broke his bat in about five spots. Let me tell you, that was not a good sound off of the wood. But it'll go down as a line drive single in the morning.
Broke two bats here in this inning, the pitcher has, but the sacks are juiced with nobody down. He is looking at some serious trouble here.
He is, but looking at the big picture here, too, the scouts are going to be impressed by broken bats. More often than not, you break a bunch of bats on inside pitches, you're going to get outs. He's just, you know, Engelken's been working through some bad luck here in the third.
That was a nasty hook right there, swung at and missed.
That's the way you get out of this bases loaded, no jam, though. You try to get a strikeout to the best of your abilities, and maybe you get a force at home with one out. Maybe you get a 6-4-3 double play, something like that.
Maybe a pop-up to get that second one. Always to try to get out of this thing unhurt. It'll have to be a little bit of a Houdini act, though. Awful tough to get out with the bases loaded and nobody down. 1-2 the count now. stretch, and here comes the 1-2 pitch with the bases loaded.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that was a fastball right on the outside corner. We had a little bit of a delayed strike three from the home plate umpire, but if he doesn't call that one, there's not a strike all day long. That was a beauty from the big right-hander.
Once he made up his mind, he was emphatic about it.
Yes,
and
he was. Yep.
It rung him up. No score here in the Get Hits All-Star Game. Rod Tompkins, Tom Johnson.
Any wind that we have right now is blowing in gently about 10 miles per hour from right field.
Kind of a crossing wind. I don't think it's going to help anything get out of here unless it's something you hit out towards left center and it's hooking a little bit. It might help something get out there. That'd be about the only place that would do it.
I'm looking at Old Glory, and that might be a little bit more from the right field corner to straightaway left. So if you can get it toward left, I'd say you're going to get a little bit of help on that crosswind. Probably more that right field to left field wind than blowing in straight from right.
Might play into the hands of the lefties who are able to hit the ball the opposite way.
There you go. That little slicer.
Here comes the 1-1. Fastball. That one.
Wow.
Had to have missed low, I'm guessing.
Oh, that is a good-looking fastball. That's the type of location. You keep the ball low like that right around the knees, that'll get you a lot of outs.
And you can never go wrong out here pitching in front of scouts, keeping the ball down.
You got that right.
That would have ground ball towards the hole. And it's in there for a base hit. That'll score at least two as we have a bobbled ball out in the left field. Thrown quickly back in and a little napping going on.
Brett Fair out of Manhattan, Kansas, a Wichita State grad. Now with a bobble, we get all three runs to cross the plate as the third run is in for Team Columbia to make it 3-0 as Griffin Robinson crosses the dish.
So now just a runner at first. Three runs in here in this top half of the third inning. Inning number 3 out of 12 here for the Get Hits All-Stars. Again, like Tom mentioned, the Navy squad in the field currently and Columbia at the plate. And
stepping in here for Team Columbia is a left-hander, Colby Fitch, out of Hickman High School in Columbia, Missouri. He's going to the University of Louisville.
Going to be a Cardinal.
They do just a little bit of winning in that athletic department. They couldn't have a better season than they did a year ago.
Yeah, women's basketball awful good. Teddy Bridgewater doing a nice job with the football team there.
Football team won the Orange Bowl. Men's basketball team, ouch, there's a hit by pitch right in the right hip. You don't come to an All-Star game expecting to get a bruise on your right hip when you go back for football season, do you?
Yeah, that probably was unintentional, don't you think?
It looked like, you know what, that was just a slider that got away. But getting back to our discussion about Louisville, their football team last year won the Sugar Bowl. They're going to the ACC next year, by the way, so they're probably going to dominate in their conference here this year. But, of course, Coach Pitino and their men's basketball team won the national championship, and their women's team, which it's completely overshadowed by the men, they were in the Final Four in April.
And very, very impressive there.
And the baseball team was in Omaha at the College World Series.
Their women ended up getting second. Didn't they get?
I think so.
I think they did. Lost in the championship game.
You bet.
So a lot of good things going on there in Lovell, as they would say.
Lovell. I've heard it.
Lovell.
Louisville.
Or either one. We're probably both wrong.
You know, it really says Louisville.
Yeah, we can go with that. It'd get us in trouble if we were there, but we could.
And I think Louisville is a small town in Kansas, though, and not on the
high. I know this, but it's right across the river from Jefferson, Indiana.
You got that. Yep.
That one, a called strike. At the plate here is going to be Keith Grieshaber, I believe.
Over the left field fence, there is a big head of a bull out there with a $100,000 bullseye on it. One of these kids hit that, they should get $100,000, I think.
I agree 100%. So I'm assuming if they hit it in the bullseye, that's what probably...
I would guess. No. Well, you know what? That looks like an empty hole there in the eye. I think they have to hit it through the bullseye.
Hit it through. That would be pretty awesome to see. What a baseball day it would be here in the Kansas City area if we had that in a walk-off grand slam. That ball... tapped down the right field line, was foul pretty much from the beginning.
Something tells me that is a T-bones deal, but you know what? If I'm an 18-year-old high school kid in an All-Star game and I do that, I at least ask.
I might even get my lawyer to look into it. Three runs already across here in the top half of the third in the Get Hits All-Star game. Nice job there behind the plate, getting out and using his body and the equipment to block that one.
You're a good friend with the law firm of Dewey, Cheatham, and Howe.
Yes. They could all be named that, however. I hope we don't have any law firms as our sponsors here on the broadcast today. I'm sure they're good-natured folks, have a little bit of a sense of humor anyway.
We say that tongue-in-cheek. There's a strike three on the outside corner.
Grieshaber goes down.
Yeah, Engelken. He gave up that that seeing eye base, had even the RBI, and his defense didn't help him out there, giving up the third run. But the RBI single was just kind of that CNI hit in the hole to left, so that wasn't necessarily hit hard.
Yes, as we look at the to go along with those three runs, three errors as well, not the friend of the Navy team. That one swung at and missed, I believe, back to Mason O'Brien here at the plate, the first baseman.
I think he's the first one that we've seen hit twice.
At least that we knew about at the time, anyway.
See if he can. Did they say cowboy up in Stillwater?
They probably do.
See if he can cowboy up with the bat in his hands. Columbia up 3-0, top of the third.
O'Brien takes that one for a called strike on the inside corner.
Good, maybe good, and the news in the night that indicates we're going to be here a while. We're not even 25% of the way done yet.
That is correct.
If the game is tied after 12, is it over, or does it go 13?
What I'm saying is I sure hope so.
We might get to bed about 2 in the morning.
Oh, that one plunked. I thought it got a piece of him, yeah, didn't it? Either in the leg or maybe the backside.
Certainly did. Maybe it hit the dirt and then bounced away. I thought that hit him in the lower leg, but...
O'Brien's I'm going to stay up here and hit. I want to get some hacks in.
Was that an optical illusion if I've ever seen one? That must have hit the dirt and then bounced away because he didn't make one move toward first base. We have second and third now with two outs.
It's an opportunity to get a hit that drives in a couple runs. And I tell you what, left center field, very inviting for this left-hand hitter. Might be one of the reasons there's all that room out there. They have elected to pitch him inside almost the entire at-bat.
I love the big berm out here in right field with all the green grass. That has to be inviting as a big left-handed hitter, too.
It would look pretty landing out there for him, I'm sure. That fastball, tap down towards third. Over to first base, Kevontae Mitchell guns him down, 5-3. Down goes the Columbia squad, but not before they make a little bit of noise. They score three runs in the top half of the third after 2.5. It is Columbia 3 over the Navy squad here in the Get Hits All-Star Game. 3-0 our score. Back with more right after this here on 810 WHB-TV. And welcome back to the broadcast here on 810 WHB-TV. Rod Tompkins alongside Tom Johnson here in the booth at Community America Ballpark. And we have a pitching change here for the Columbia team. Ryan Ralston takes to the mound for him. Tell us about him, Tom.
Mack and Seitz team, I think you have some familiarity with, Rod, there in the summer here from the Kansas City area. He's out of Overland Park, Kansas, and he is, so far, he's an unsigned young man. You don't think there's a lot of college coaches rolling around here trying to get some talent for next season?
Oh, no doubt. Left-hand hitter, or a right-hand pitcher, left-hand hitter, Clayton Custer steps in to face him. I don't know if he's any relation to George.
Well, he's the young man, and he doesn't look like he's all that tall. He kind of looks like maybe a guard type because he's going to play basketball up in Ames at ISU.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah, and you look at him, and he's certainly not 6'8 or a big bruising guy who's going to play inside, so I'd imagine he can probably handle the ball and shoot the three.
Oh, I would definitely guess that's the case.
At least if he's going to play Division I baseball, you hope he does.
Or basketball, yeah. I'm surprised I'm not familiar with the young man, to be quite honest with you. I'm surprised I hadn't heard his name before. And
he sent some of the folks scattering. He hit a mean line drive right over the dugout of the Columbia team.
Well, he's not happy. His team's down 3-0, so he directed that one over there. And that's some precise bat handling to be able to do that.
Well, that's called over-competitiveness there. There's another line drive screaming down the left field line.
Well, that's a little bit overkill there to go for the shot again down there.
Now he's going for his third base coach.
And Clayton Custer, don't aggravate him. That'd be my advice.
Best part of this ballpark, is there anything not nicer than seeing the number 22 jersey of Buck O'Neill retired on the left field fence?
That's awesome stuff right there.
Can't find a finer ambassador, the late Buck O'Neill, than he was for Major League Baseball in Kansas City.
And he's a great, great man, no doubt about it. And
never had a chance to meet him and wish I would have.
I'll tell you what I've never had a chance to do, and I'd encourage anyone to do it. I've always heard great things. I've talked to the curator of the Negro Leagues Museum here in Kansas City. Never had the pleasure of being there. It's not on my bucket list, but it's on my to-do list at least. Anyway.
Well, it's close enough that it should be on your bucket list. If you're like us and you live within 100 miles of the Negro Leagues Hall of Fame, you should make it a point to go there, and I haven't been there either, so maybe you and I should make a road trip here next summer.
That'd be awesome. We'd have a good time. Doctor, I can't think of his last name now, the curator there of the museum.
Bob Kendrick.
Yes, yep. Awesome guy.
Oh, the amount of stories that he has are awesome. He was one of the guest speakers earlier this year when the Royals had a lot of their media affiliates for Affiliates Day out at the K back in, I think it was May or June or something like that. And just a great guy. You could probably tell stories all afternoon long if he had the opportunity to.
No question. I was supposed to be there at Affiliates Day, didn't make it that day. Gianola comes to the plate now. It's Austin Gianola. The runner at first and nobody down. That fastball bunted right in front of the plate. Nice.
Wow.
So that's
I have never seen that. A bunt that went straight up in the air about 5 feet. The catcher came up from home plate and he barehanded it and threw a pee down to first base, not in time to double up the runner, but that was a great play.
That's Greg behind the plate and doing a nice job. That was cat-like.
I'm still trying to figure out how a kid from Blue Valley West ends up with the East Cobb Braves. We still think are in Georgia and maybe Atlanta, but I don't know. Long way between one and the other.
That ball on the steal attempt, chucked out into center field. Safe down at second is Clayton Custer. And
I would like to know Custer's size, considering he's going to play hoops.
All right. So it says something to me that he's out here playing in this game. When he's headed to ISU to play hoops, I'm a little surprised they want him out here playing, to be quite honest with you.
I would think that would make the mayor a little bit, at least, nervous.
Old Fred Hoiberg. That guy could chuck the tray a little bit.
As far as Big 12 hoops goes, you keep on thinking that Iowa State's going to win the conference one of these years, but somebody has to beat KU in order for that to happen. What a job Bill Self does.
Oh, tremendous. I hate to give him that much credit.
Yeah, you have to, though.
Being a Missouri fan, it's awful tough for him. That ball out into center field and the second backup and, two pitches by the center fielder.
You know, as Missouri people, we are on Kansas soil right now, so you got to give credit where credit is due.
Begrudgingly, I'm able to do this. mainly out of the fact I like to aggravate Jim Bly, the manager at WHB-TV. He's a big Jayhawk fan.
He brings that up every once in a while.
Quality program, quality coach. Everything I've ever heard about him, he's a good man. Might work an official or two, allegedly.
Why is it they ask that? He has to send me 14 texts after the Jayhawks win 13-10, though.
That's just the way he rolls.
I'm kidding, Jim. He didn't text me once. I think he had a Facebook post yesterday when KU got that fourth quarter touchdown. He's awfully excited.
Oh. Not the best hit ball we've seen in this game. Headed towards the gap, and a diving attempt by the center fielder. That one's going to trickle all the way to the warning track out there near the 400 mark, and it's going to be a triple.
For Elijah Dilday. He clobbered that ball, as Danny Matthews would say on his broadcast over the years, and so many Royals fans like to hear, belted to right center, and that's what Dilday did on that. The St. Louis product out of Francis Howell High School, he got an inside fastball, and he roped it to right center field, and almost a great catch out there made by the center fielder.
And I believe our score incorrect, isn't it? They had it up to 4-0. Should be 3-1, shouldn't it? Or 3-2? Didn't we score a run there?
Yeah, 3-1.
3-1.
3-1, yeah.
Wonder if they'll get that right in a minute.
Makes us feel proud, and we know the score, and the official scorer doesn't, though.
Right. I'm kind of counting on them today.
Yeah, we're still waiting.
We'll see if we can't eventually get that corrected. That was Dilday. Kyle Reed at the plate. Reed waves at that one and gets a piece of it and hits it off to the right field side, well back out of play. Man, this is a beautiful place for baseball.
Oh, I was just about to say, as much as we wanted to make it our bucket list and maybe make a trip down to Kansas City to see the Negro League's Hall of Fame sometime next year, if not, you know, before the end of this year, we got to come down here, watch a T-Bones game.
We'll do that. We'll hit the museum, come out and watch a T-Bones game, and then Jim Bly can take us to Britt's, which is a good place. He's taken me there several times.
Oh, really?
Yes.
I want to hear
it. It's a good place, great people out there.
The Jim Rod stories are always worth about $1 million, or with the $100,000.
Sometimes I'd pay you $1 million just to keep them quiet.
Yeah, you know how that goes.
Breaking ball there, catches the inside corner, little backdoor breaking ball.
You can tell from these pitchers, from watching some high school ball over the years, where the goal is slow throw strikes, get over the plate and kind of work on some stuff. You know, some of the pitchers that we have here today, we've seen some at the very least. High minor league quality off-speed pitches. That was another 12-6 curveball.
I would have to agree with you. That was a very nice pitch. It was the backdoor variety. And going to bring up Shane Bennis now. Another St. Louis area player, I believe, plays at Westminster. Is that right?
That's correct. Westminster Christian Academy, private school out of St. Louis. Played for the Rawlings St. Louis Prospects, and he's going to MU here this fall.
Go Tigers. High inside fastball there. Maybe I think he just got away from our pitcher, not trying to back him off the plate or anything. This is a game where, if you're a pitcher, though, and you want to show what you've got to pitch like it's, it's the playoffs or a state title game or something like that. You can't give these guys anything, or they're going to turn it around on you.
And I said this fall, I have to remember what time of year it is. It already is the fall.
He's
graduating next year, so he's going to start at MU here next fall.
The one thing I noticed as I went over the roster for this game, the size of these impressive young athletes, most of them, the vast majority, at least 6 foot tall. There is a slew of them around 6'3 to 6'5. One young man, 6'8, 265, I noticed on the roster.
Shane Bennis has a 3.9 GPA. He can probably pick his major at Mizzou.
I would say so. Tell you what, kids with great GPAs, depending on what their baseball skills are, as Bennis takes a walk right there, depending on what their skills are, programs really love kids that have great academics. It opens up another scholarship spot.
And not only programs, but had an opportunity, if folks missed it, to talk with Steve Gossett. He's one of the scouts here for the New York Mets at the game today, right up to a first pitch. And if you're a 3.9, 3.95, 4.0 GPA guy, major league teams, if you have maybe above average athletic ability, but your smarts are just way, way, way up there, you can be that smart. And that will allow you to get a pretty good spot on a major league roster if you know how to run the bases and know what you're doing out there.
Oh, no doubt. It shows the work ethic. Hey, we got the sign working out in right field now. The Verizon fastest fastball sign, I believe it's referred to as out there. The last pitch was at 82 mile per hour. That last one not registering. But
most importantly, they have a run up on the board for Navy, so the scoreboard has now matched the broadcast.
Now we can relax a little bit. Breaking ball there. Use of the equipment. Keeping it in front of him, nice job, but I tell you what, good aggressive base running right there in to score a run for Navy. So I was trying to make sure who we had coming in there, but he was able to escape into the dugout.
3-2.
It's going to be, that's Dilday that comes in to score right there.
Correct.
At the plate is Gutter Trout Wine, Fairway, Kansas. Is that right?
Gutter Trout Wine from, this is where it helps that the last names are in alphabetical order. Yes, Shawnee Mission East, Fairway, Kansas, Wichita State, Wheat Shocker.
Tell you what, them Shockers know a little something about some baseball as well.
Gene Stevenson, and you might have to refresh my memory, he is going to retire or is retired or at least is in the process somewhere.
I can't tell you for sure. When I think Wichita State, here's the things I think of. On a baseball field, Darren Dreifert.
Yes.
And then the football field, I don't think about anything.
Because they haven't had football, but they have one heck of a track meet, the Kansas Track Championships every spring. And their basketball team has done something that, you know, as us as MU people would say, MU has never done.
Right. Here's a little old school Wichita State basketball for you. How about Antoine Carr?
How about Xavier McDaniel?
I was going to come with him next. Antoine, well ahead of him there, though, at least a few years ahead of him.
You have that as your starting forwards. Now, I know KU can probably have a couple of pretty good starting forwards in the last 20 years on their squad. Maybe you throw Paul Pierce on there, but as my starting forwards, I'd go with Antoine Carr and Xavier McDaniel and roll with that.
Well, I tell you what, Antoine could score, he could board, and wasn't nobody taking many rebounds from Xavier McDaniel.
You could find a pretty good squad there from the late 80s, early 90s from just Kansas schools, couldn't you?
Oh, you absolutely could.
Antoine Carr, Xavier McDaniel, Danny Manning, Mitch Richmond from K-State.
Right.
There's four.
I'm gonna go clear on back to Rolando Blackman at K-State.
I'll see a Rolando Blackman. I'll go way in the Wayback Machine and go Wilt the Stilt.
At Kansas. I was going to go a little further back at K-State for you, and I was going to go I was going to go a little further back for you there. Go with some Ed Neely. What do you think about that?
Oh, that's very nice.
Easy Ed.
That's very nice, yeah. I don't remember Ed from the college ranks. He's before my time. I remember him with the Bulls in the 90s, though.
Absolutely. Hey, as we get ready for our next hitter to come up, we're going to take a short little break. I'm going to do a little visiting. We'll be right back here on 810 WHB TV.
They got some coin in the southwest suburbs. That's where you go, Olathe. Yep. Nice to meet you. Oh, yeah? Renegades might be the last team that plays in Kemper before they knock it to the ground. That might be the... Here's Wahlberg.
All right, we're back here at Community America Ballpark, the home of the Kansas City T-Bones and...
Future Texas Tech Red Raider at the plate. Quinton Wahlberg out of Santa Fe High School in Edmond, Oklahoma. The Oklahoma Fuel is where he played his summer ball.
Oklahoma known for a great summer season of baseball down there, Ben Johnson type things, and a slew of junior colleges, Division II, Division III schools down there. A lot of talent coming out of those schools, a lot of Major League Baseball players.
One of the events, and I'm sure Oklahoma sends a lot of people to this event that I'd love to cover, and never had the opportunities at NBC World Series down in Wichita. Through the night, through the day, they just play 24 hours worth of baseball, and it is one of the better under-the-radar events in this country.
One of my goals is to broadcast some games from there. Jim and I have talked to some folks out there and plan on doing that at some point. Of course, they have the Mink League involved in that.
And, correct.
You know, teams from all over the country.
Folks are familiar with the Mink League. That is a lot of Missouri teams in there. Chillicothe, St. Joseph, Joplin is in there. The Joplin Outlaws, the Ozark Generals are in there, along with Clarinda A's, the Omaha Diamond Spirit, and you probably know more than I am.
Sedalia Bombers, did you get them already?
No, you just added them.
Okay, all right, got something right there. And that is the Missouri, Iowa, Nebraska, Kansas League. And all would bet, some would equate it to high A or maybe double A baseball. Oh. Another diving attempt out there, and It was a ball that I didn't think that he ever stood a chance of catching whenever he laid out for it. But he did have the wherewithal once he missed that to get his glove up and stop that ball from going further into right field. That easily would have been a triple had he not got that knocked down.
Same type of play that's Benninghoff out there in the right field. He had the sun in his eyes in the first inning, and he didn't have any idea where the ball was landing in front of him. It's a lot easier field right now. There's a little bit of sun, but it's not nearly as strong out in deep right center field right now. Everything between Benninghoff and home plates is, as far as he's concerned, is beautiful shade, so he's able to get a pretty good read off that ball and probably should have had that one. A tough catch, but it did hit his glove.
And the sun just about to become a non-factor here in this one.
Yeah, and even the sun that we see from straightaway center 396 into deep right center field, it almost looks like it's muted right now. Not nearly as strong shining off the grass.
That is right. I believe we've got Brett Fear at the plate here. 3-2 at Columbia jumped out in front and had a 3-0 lead. The Navy team bounced back, as, you know, athletes that are talented and have big hearts do. That ball lined out into right field. We had trouble right here.
Double play. Good arm. Good arm showing out there in right field on that play by Benninghoff. And that was not very good base running. That won't show.
I guarantee there's a little writing of some notes right there on that throw by Benninghoff. He's got a hose, as they would say.
That's how you get an SEC scholarship to the University of Arkansas. He's from Overland Park, and he's not the first kid from Overland Park to go to Arkansas. I don't know if I'd call it a pipeline, but there's definitely been one or two kids that have done that particular tracker over the years.
I'll tell you what, whether it be in Wyandotte County or you go into Johnson County, both of them, there's been a lot of great athletes come out of both counties here in this Kansas City metropolitan area, and pretty impressive. I was out and had the chance to cover the Midwest Classic, the web.com tour event, and my brother lives in Olathe, and was staying with him while I was there, and got to drive past the Overland Park soccer complexes and all of the things that they have out here. There's just of course, it's known as being one of the more affluent counties, literally, in the United States, and it shows. But the thing is, there's some affluence here, but they're putting it back into this community, providing things for their kids, additional opportunities, and you know, on top of what they've ever had. And it's obviously they care a lot, and it's really benefiting these kids.
You know, Olathe Overland Park, there's a ton of coin, as you said. You call it affluence, I'll just call it coin. But a little bit north of there, this area that we're
Leewood, another one.
This area that we're sitting in right now, the press box at Community America Ballpark, and the Kansas Speedway nearby, and the home of Sporting Kansas City. In this place, if you go back a little looper down left field line, that's going to slice foul. I moved to Hiawatha, Kansas, my first job down in this area of the country in 1998, about New Year's Day. You would have come down here January 1st, 1998. This is a cornfield. There was nothing here, and now look at there's a lot of money involved, but they've done a great job here in Kansas City, Kansas, with this whole area around these two interstates.
Oh, it's incredible what's happened in this particular area. That one tapped it out towards first base. Again, a close play.
Got him.
These guys, you can tell, maybe not working a lot together on that on the PFP, the pitcher's fielding practice and things like that. Also, later in the year, a lot of these kids have had some time off by now. Maybe on some of the some of the fundamentals lacking a little bit, the things that they practice every day just so they become automatic. Maybe a little bit rusty, but they get it covered right there, and that ends things here in the top half of the fourth. After 3.5, Columbia leads the Navy squad here at the Get Hits All-Star Game 3-2. Rod Tompkins, Tom Johnson, Jim Bly out here covering it for you right here on 810 WHB-TV. Rod Tompkins, Tom Johnson back with you. We'll let Tom carry you through this majority of this inning with his play-by-play, Northern Flair, although it may have.
I thought I had lost the Northern Flair, but
I said you lost some.
Well, there have been some pretty good guys to put on the play-by-play headphones with some Northern Flair.
Right. You're one of them.
I don't know how many people would know some of these names, but you know, Herb Carneal, late Herb Carneal. Ryan LaFever is a University of Minnesota grad, so there you go. From
what about Ernie Harwell? I know he was the Detroit guy. Where was that? I wonder where he hailed from.
I don't know. It's a good question.
That guy was good.
Well, he was one of my favorites. The voice of summer in Southeast Michigan is what he was called for about four decades. There's that overhand curveball, and it froze the hitter at the plate. Strike three on a dandy-looking overhand curve from the right-hander Logan Wiley out of Kickapoo, Missouri.
That'd be Springfield Kickapoo.
Exactly, Midwest Nationals, and he's one of those unsigned guys here in his senior year in high school. That curveball right there, that'll get you signed by somebody.
I guarantee it. Kevonte Mitchell comes to the plate now.
It's an eye-opener. He grounds his ball slowly down the third baseline. That'll be played foul a couple of feet right in front of the base. The pitcher right now for Team Columbia. We just talked about him, Logan Wiley, Springfield Kickapoo product.
He's not a real big kid. He's certainly not a real broad-shouldered kid, but another good breaking ball.
Yeah, and, well, I tell you what, I think he has the highest GPA of anybody here, Rod. He is 4.2 on the GPA scale.
It's pretty impressive stuff. Obviously had his priorities very straight. That a fastball that Kevonte Mitchell quickly figures out he's not going to catch up to.
We haven't seen, at least the last few years, in some, you know, basketball and football specifically, but there's a swing and a miss. The ball is bobbled by the catcher. You'll have to chase it down. He needs to go throw to first, and it's in time.
Kevonte Mitchell's speed certainly going to get him signed somewhere. He looked like a gazelle gliding down there to first base, yeah. Only faster.
Well, and for whatever reason, down there in the southeastern corner of the state, we've seen a lot of basketball teams play in the Missouri State Championships from, you know, Scott County Central and Sykeston and Cape Girardeau and some of those schools. You know, I think Kennett might have been in their last March, as I recall. Maybe
I do believe it may have been on the girls' side. I will not verify that or know sure or anything, but I do remember seeing it. And Kennett, another, it's a great baseball area. I know a lot of the Babe Ruth leagues and the younger youth leagues will play their big tournaments down there, whether it be sectional, some of them maybe even national tournaments. Obviously, you know, a young kid comes out there, sees that, and the kind of fun those kids are having, that just does nothing but, you know, boost their interest in baseball and their desire to get out there and play and be successful.
Yeah, there's something in the water there south of Cape Girardeau. There's a fastball inside, and taking a walk here for Team Navy is Taylor Sanagorski, the Wichita native, Wichita State signee with a 4.05 GPA. Something in the water, though, that from Cape Girardeau south, that is not a huge population area, but pound for pound, Otto Porter, who both you and I saw for, I think, four straight years at the Missouri Class 1 Championships. His team won three straight championships, and he just, I don't know if he signed, but he got picked by, was it Washington in the NBA
Correct.
Draft, I think, picked
about
number three.
Three or four, very well, many thought should have been the number one pick, and that's just awesome for a kid out of a Class 1 school in Missouri. It used to be Class 2 at one point, but his dad, a very successful player, I believe played there at SEMO was where he played
exactly,
at.
Exactly, yep.
And he is impressive.
I've heard a lot of people say the dad was better than the son, and the son was a stud at Georgetown.
And I don't think he ever played in the NBA, as far as I know. I will not say that for sure. But Otto Porter Jr., a lot of fun to watch. I had the fortune of calling him a game. Not fortunate for the Bramer Bobcats, however.
Nor the Newtown Harris Tigers in the championship game that he played in his sophomore years. That Scott County team was dominating. There's a swing and a miss on another hook. I tell you what, the fourth inning here for Team Columbia, getting themselves perhaps a college scholarship somewhere there. That was impressive work by the diminutive right-hander from Columbia in retiring at Team Navy. I think four at-bats, one walk, and I think he struck out the side.
Awful impressive stuff. Not signed collegially. He may skip that, go straight on there. Take a young man like that, who obviously brings a lot of things to the table. They'll start him down there in that rookie league low A ball. let him kind of come into his own, get him on some weights and things like that.
Most of these kids are seniors here, too. Logan Wiley, who just did the great pitching there. He's only a junior. He graduates in 2015.
Just a junior. Probably got a growth spurt in front of him. Going to have a lot more experience as well. That's why he's not signed yet. Still got another year left. Baseball, they're a little funny. They don't sign him they don't sign him 2 and 3 years early like, oh, say the Razorbacks did. Rafe Peavy out of Bolivar, they signed him or had him committed, I guess I should say, as a sophomore to play for the Razorbacks, who are still undefeated too, aren't they?
No, the football team?
Yes.
Lost to Rutgers yesterday.
Oh, they were ahead in that game. That's the last thing I saw.
Rutgers had a big comeback. Arkansas has taken some grief over that. West Virginia, you know, the new team in the Big 12, they're terrible this year. They got drilled by Maryland in, I guess they're calling it a neutral site game in Baltimore yesterday at the Ravens Stadium, but last time I checked, Baltimore is in Maryland. So I think
yes, it is. I don't know how neutral that is.
No. That's like, you know, playing Missouri at Arrowhead Stadium instead of Columbia and saying that it's a neutral site game.
Right. Of course, the only one that's neutral in football, MU, KU, they play at Arrowhead. That's pretty neutral right there, I would have to say. It's split pretty well down the middle.
That was interesting to me because of how much closer the Lawrence campus is to Kansas City, the Columbia campus. But as Missouri people would say, if you're playing at Arrowhead, you're playing on Missouri soil. So there's a little bit of that. I think that added to the spice of the back and forth.
Right. We could talk all day about that rivalry, one which will be renewed at some point.
We might be 75 years old by the time it does.
So next year for me. Well, that was it. I like to pick on myself. If I do it, nobody else gets to that way.
Yeah, I laugh too hard at that. Because I'm not very far behind you.
Well, I thought maybe my delivery was just that good.
It was. It was.
My comedic timing impeccable.
It was very self-deprecating.
Yeah, and I excel in that area. Very few others, but in that one I do. Rod Tompkins, Tom Johnson here at the Get Hits All-Star Game, and we're at beautiful Community America Ballpark, Kansas City, Kansas.
You can pick out whatever it is. You got a JCPenney and a Target across the street, and you have that Dave and Buster sign.
I want to see the guy hit that Dave and Buster sign. I didn't mean to cut you off. That's a pretty impressive shot if they're able to hit that. That's about a half mile away, I guess.
Oh, I tell you, what is that? If you hit it there, that's 1,750 feet away.
Yeah, probably at least that, I would guess.
Wow. But yeah, that's
over, Bryce Harper might be able to do it.
That's over a building.
And a parking lot and a couple other things.
And that D&B sign is at least a good 100 feet in the air.
Right. I'd recommend people go there. It's a fun place, though. It's of course, there is nothing but fun places to go to right here in this vicinity.
We just get free advertising with the advertising on the outfield walls. That's the way it works in this business.
Right.
So, you know, they got that big Arthur Bryant sign there. You can't talk Kansas City without that.
And, of course, we'll give some equal pub to the folks at Gates, too.
Why not? And Oklahoma Joe's.
There we go. Grounded up the middle. Ranges into his left, the shortstop. Able to gun down the hitter at 6-3.
Retired there was number 11 on your scorecard. Tanner, Greg, how's your scorecard looking there, Rod?
Poor.
Been better.
Yes, he was number 11 in your program there, Greg was. Number one, of course, in your heart, Tanner Gregg.
You know what this would be if we were on Twitter actually talking about this game and you have hashtags? I don't know how much you tweet for a living.
Yeah. Hashtag disorganized?
Hashtag all-star probs.
Oh, yeah. You could come up with a lot of them. Not all of them are our fault. I'll tell you who did do a good job. Jim Bly got out here, set up all the equipment, shook the hands, kissed the babies. He did it all.
We had to fight traffic on the way down, which was pretty gnarly.
Right. I have been on the in the car already 6 hours today. That one misses down low. Been in at six, got about two left, and I get to make a trek up to a place known for sprint car racing, Knoxville, Iowa.
Oh,
headed
yeah.
there in the morning.
Oh, yeah. You find out very quickly. If you go any further southeast and you say Knoxville, it's Tennessee Volunteers. Any place around Kansas City, you say Knoxville, you're going to Iowa.
That's right. See guys like Donnie Schatz and Danny Lasoski and the Kinzers and folks like that. It's a lot of fun. They put on great races up there.
3-2 the score here with Team Columbia over Team Navy. Kind of gliding along here in the top of the fifth. We're going 12 tonight.
Swung on a miss. That's good heat right there.
The pitcher for Team Navy with that good high heat, tough to lay off, Clayton McGinnis. He is from Amazonia, Missouri, and Savannah High School, a Savage who played for the Kansas City Bullets. young man who was a freshman for Kansas State last year, Blake McFadden from Savannah.
Went 6-2, 7-2, something like that. A great ERA. You got a little bit. They got to him a little bit in that big game as Oregon State, I believe they were taking on. And I tell you what, as a freshman in the Big 12, a great baseball conference, you come in, you have a record of 6-2. One of the better ERA staffs on the ERAs on the staff speaks to the talent of that young man. Speaks to the confidence and the talents of head coach Brad Hill too.
As a freshman, you come in, too, you're going against a lot of juniors and seniors who are 21, 22 years old. And pitching in Corvallis, Oregon, that's a whole different deal in the NCAAs and pitching in the MEC for Savannah.
It sure is. I called a few of Blake's games over the years, and I think two at least that I called, and he was an impressive kid, throwing no more than 80% of what the best was that he had against most high school competition. Was taking a little bit off most of the time and still dominated. Second place finish for them, another Final Four appearance for the Savages back in the day. But that's going to end things here in the top half of the fifth. 3-2 our score at the Get Hits All-Star Game. Columbia leads the Navy squad 3-2. Back with more after this here on 810 WHB-TV.
Welcome back to Community America Ballpark here in beautiful Kansas City, Kansas, one of the quickest growing areas. And if it's not the quickest growing area in the state of Kansas, I don't know what would be. As the pitcher here for Team Columbia, he's from right down the street here at Blue Valley West High School, and the Mackensites Indians from Overland Park, Connor Kaiser, wearing number 10.
His first pitch, a good-looking fastball, but it misses down and in.
Every time we look up, Clayton Custer, the Iowa State's basketball product, is at the plate, and here he is again.
He may have a change of heart. He looks pretty impressive out here on the baseball diamond as well. He wouldn't be here if he wasn't, but
he'd break the heart of the mayor if he did that.
He might. Of course, the mayor, that might give him an opportunity to sign a 6'8 guy.
I'm impressed that Iowa State actually bringing a guy in from high school. That's like team prance for the last three or four years.
I'm impressed they're bringing in a guy from Kansas. They don't like to do that, probably.
That's the Jayhawks, who rarely sign guys from Kansas, although they got a pretty good one from Wichita.
That's right.
Perry Ellis, be the name of that young
man. I love his cologne.
Oh, that's very nice. It doesn't happen often, but it doesn't hurt to recruit the home state if you're the Jayhawks.
Oh, no doubt about it. I have to sit down and look at the numbers and who they've had over the years. There hasn't been a ton of them. Had a ground ball to the second baseman, and Custer down 4-3 here in the bottom half of the fifth.
Give some credit to the Rockhurst Hocklets out of Lee's Summit. Trey Vickers making that play at second base.
Made it look awful easy. It was a pretty routine play, but the way Custer gets down the line, he had to make sure he got plenty on the throw, and not a guy who you'll be able to afford to bobble one with either. That one tapped towards the hole. Third baseman over. Makes an easy throw over to first base. And I tell you what, he made that routine, and it was anything but that.
That was that in-between play, too, where the third baseman in that case That was at number 9 on your scorecard, Quentin Wahlberg. If he lets that ball get by him as slow as it was, that's an infield single. That's one you have to move to your left, cut off if you're the third baseman. And Wahlberg did a tremendous job in throwing a P over to first base.
Wahlberg looking good. Looked pretty good at the plate as well earlier.
We need him to make the big leagues and make it a big splash in the big leagues just so we don't have to hear about that other Wahlberg, Donnie.
I'll tell you what, pretty good actor, though.
Not bad, not bad. But you need to have another Wahlberg in the
right
in the spotlight.
That pitch misses down and in.
We're starting to see the pitchers take a little bit of control again. The pitchers have generally been dominant in this game, even the third inning when we had the five runs scored. A lot of seeing eye base hits. We haven't seen anything hit hard much at all here this afternoon.
Check, the pitcher's throwing well, but now with the sun coming out of play, and it was a factor, no two ways about it, was a factor in the three errors that were made by Columbia. Had a good change of pace right there that swung on a missed.
Way out on the front foot trying to get to that ball was Elijah Dilday, and he had the hardest hit ball bar none of this ball game, a ringing triple into the right center field gap last at bat.
Hit it to the second deepest part of the park. That one fouled off the catcher, maybe off the mask of the umpire as well, and straight back to the screen.
I've never had that happen, but I have to imagine that almost works like a nice early evening cup of coffee.
Yes, it will. Tend to wake you up just a little bit.
Coffee probably tastes a little bit better, but it does do the same in waking you up.
Right.
It's 5-hour energy without the price.
Dilley takes that one inside, almost got a piece of him.
We've seen a lot of that inside action, too, and baseball's coming in and hitting batters. Way more than you should be seeing in an all-star game.
Well, an off-speed pitch at 72 miles per hour. Not a fastball, high and away. As the
Kaiser missed up. And that will bring to the plate for Team Navy out of Blue Springs High School, Kyle Reed, future Missouri State Bear.
Reed up there, he struck out his last time at the plate. Fastball misses downstairs. Snap throw down to first, and I'll tell you what, that was a close play.
There's not a bad-looking arm there behind the plate for Colby Fitch. He's out. We know where this is. He's out of officially Rocheport, Missouri, over there on the Missouri River. If you're heading to the university and you go across the river there on I-70, you go through the little community of Rocheport.
That's either Saline County or Cooper County. I can't tell you which one for sure.
No, but he went from Rocheport. There's no Rocheport High School. Too small for that, so he played at Columbia Hickman.
Played at Hickman. I would say that's probably Cooper County then. It's, of course, Hickman going to be in Boone County. But
Hickman would be the very tough-sounding QPs.
Yes. I'll check you on some history here in a minute. Breaking ball upstairs and an easy stolen base. Yeah.
The jump that the young man for Team Navy got there, that was he had about 5 or 6 steps before that ball was released. Elijah Dilday, he stole that on the pitcher.
Sure did. Seemed like the man on the mound just kind of
forgot about him.
Forgot about him and was worrying about dealing to the hitter, which is, with runners on, is a great idea. But with the guys over there, it's something you need to take into account.
Right now, Kaiser snapping the mitts of his starting catcher, Colby Fitch. That's not doing a whole lot when you're throwing the ball up.
That pitch right about 80 mile an hour, and if you throw it 80 in belt high, somebody's going to turn one around on you.
That pitch was in the dirt, and it's a walk, and advancing to third base with that pitch just barely just crawling through the legs of the catcher Fitch, the lead base runner there. Moves on to third base, and it's runners at the corners and 2 outs. It's Team Columbia trying to add some insurance here to this 3-2 lead. We're still in the very early part of this ball game, not even halfway with the game scheduled for 12.
You are. I believe we're going to have a pinch hitter. Joey Wentz going to come to the plate. Out of Lee Wood goes to is that Shawnee Mission High School left? Got him down for. That one gets all the way to the backstop, and another run comes across. It's Navy going to tie it up 3-3.
Joey Wentz, Shawnee Mission East, Kansas City Barnstormers out of Leewood, Kansas. As the crow flies, that would be just a little bit further north in Overland Park if you're making your way up 35 toward downtown.
Athletic, smooth swinging lefty here.
Somewhat. I'm not going to say he's anywhere in the ballpark yet, but kind of reminds you a little bit maybe of a young Eric Hosmer.
Kind of his approach at the plate and the way he sets up there, I would say, reminds you of that.
There's a
second half, Eric Hosmer, I hope.
Yeah, exactly. There's a better example here, but I just can't come up with a good one off the top of my head. Just that tall, lean, left-handed hitter. little bit of a knee bend.
He is Hosmer-esque, though.
He's left-handed at the very least.
Yes, that part, we get at least some percentage points for getting that part correct.
If he turns on a ball here and yanks it onto the berm in right field, he'd be very much Hosmer-esque.
Pitch a fastball, swung on and missed, and he had intentions of going there with it.
But the pitch was outside. If he would have hit that ball, he would have grounded it out to the second baseman or the first baseman. That's turning over on one.
Never good to roll over. Better to do it with that runner at second than it was with him at first.
Runner on second on the move. That might have been the run and hit rather than the hit and run, and the ball is fouled back to the screen. We've seen a lot of runners on the move here tonight. The players in this All-Star game, they're trying to show off a little bit to Major League scouts, and they're trying to show their speed and their ability to go 90 feet.
We've seen a few that have been able to do it. Tell you what, I was impressed early with the speed of Clayton Custer. That he got down to second quickly. That one swung on in the dirt. I'll have to throw down to first to record the out.
Wentz.
Down goes Wentz.
Out on the front foot, that was a nice-looking slider down and in. And after five complete, I'm still wondering if it goes extra innings if we go to a 13th, because right now the game is tied.
I doubt we'll go. It's a showcase kind of event. We probably won't go into extra. We'll deal with that. We'll cross that bridge when we come to it.
How's that? We've got a long way between here and there.
Yes, we do. We're almost halfway there. We got five complete out of 12 played. 3-3 our score. We haven't decided anything on the scoreboard. We decided we got a lot of talented kids out here, though, at Community America Ballpark in KCK. Rod Tompkins, Tom Johnson, here on 810 WHB-TV. Rod Tompkins, Tom Johnson, Community America Ballpark, the Get Hits All-Star. That one lined into left field, and that one...
Trey Vickers, the future Wichita State Wheat Shocker, and the current Rockhurst Hawklet with the line drive single first pitch here in the top of the sixth inning.
Nothing like a crisp base hit to bolster your favor among scouts and coaches.
Very true. If you see that first... Don't let the cheese go by you. I think that's the phrase for that one. If you see a good fastball on the first pitch you see, take a hack at it.
Tell you a guy who's awful good about hacking at that first pitch, a guy that the Royals have seen a lot of the last few days here, former Missouri Tiger Ian Kinsler.
Boy, he can rake.
About 150 leadoff home runs in his career.
Baseman.
Last guy was great at taking that first pitch fastball. Didn't have a lot of love for him when he was playing because I didn't like to see him stealing more bases than Willie Wilson, but Ricky Henderson. Boy, that guy hit a lot of leadoff home runs.
Royals,
your old boy Chuck Knobloch hit his fair share too.
Yes, Royals have a guy as we get the pitch here, swung on and missed, but off the glove of the catcher to the backstop. There'll be a pass ball, And the runner at first base rambles down to second. Trey Vickers on second. I was going to mention a guy that we know both know very well in the Royals front office who has did a great job with Philadelphia in building their 2008 World Series a championship team, Mike Arbuckle. I wonder if he's roaming around here today.
I bet he is. And, I know this much. If he is, he'd be more than happy to come up and have a few words with us. Great guy. Always enjoy talking baseball with him. And
he was a great player back in the day, too. As I understand it, he Trenton High School up in North Central Missouri and Trenton Junior College, now North Central Missouri College. He played there, and he ended up getting an injury. I had a lot of people say that he really had major league ability, if not for an injury back in the late 60s.
Right. I believe he told me, actually, that he was the number two pitcher on that Trenton staff at the time, too. When you got a guy that's good enough to play in the major league, suffers an injury, but a guy even better than him, I imagine they won a whole lot of games back then.
And here's, you know, if you're familiar with the sport of baseball, Colby Fitch, he kind of rolled over on that one and had a lazy ground ball to second for the out, but he got a little fist pound there from his teammate because you know what? That's a productive out. That is something that the scouts will notice when you hit the ball to the right side to throw it on second.
Situational hitting.
Exactly. Moving to third with one out. Now see if you can get a sacrifice fly and get yourself a lead.
82-mile-an-hour fastball misses down and away.
Keith Grieshaber out of Marquette High School. That's in the St. Louis area, and he is going to be an Arkansas Razorback here after his senior year in high school.
He comes set at the belt, looks over to the third, then deals.
He's already wearing that Arkansas red hat. I'm trying to see if that's an Arkansas logo on that hat.
I cannot tell.
I saw one of the young men here look like he was wearing a Missouri Tiger helmet out there. Black and gold M, saw before the game.
85-mile-an-hour fastball misses high and in. And I sure thought the way he came over that it was a curveball, but it's by far the hardest pitch he's thrown here so far. That one misses down and in. Took a little something off.
That was only 79, so we're not seeing a lot of 95s, but that's something that you can develop here, too, after high school. You get yourself into the minor leagues or the collegiate system. Because if you're throwing 85 mile-per-hour cheese at the big league level, you're getting hit pretty hard.
Unless you're Bruce Chinn.
Yeah, well, he's changing speeds, though, too. I don't know if anything that Bruce Chinn throws I'd describe as cheese.
I heard he might have broke glass one time. That ball lined into right field towards the line and in for a hit. Cut off by the right fielder in a nice play, and he'll quickly get it back in and save the run, but it'll be a stand-up double.
Yeah, it is Mason O'Brien, the future Oklahoma State Cowboy. That was in on his hands a little bit, but he got good wood on that pitch, up and in, and he laced it down the right field line for a two-bagger.
So that was Robinson out in right field. He did a good job to get that flag down and knocked down before it got to the wall. It definitely saved a run and probably saved a triple for O'Brien.
Where's number 33, left-handed hitter? It looks like he has a little bit of the same mannerism, same swing as former White Sox, former Yankee, now Cleveland Indian, Nick Swisher.
He does appear to have a little better physique than Nick, however. Not that my physique is anything to write home about.
Nick, though, married to the actress who was on the Reba series back in the day, though. Played Reba's daughter in that series, Joanna Garcia.
Really? I did not know that.
Yeah. So he married up.
He's done well.
getting that major league contract doesn't hurt in those matters.
I imagine they're living pretty well together on those.
Not bad.
Good breaking ball. Misses just outside. 72-mile-an-hour on that pitch. Going over a little bit overboard on the mile-per-hour per pitch thing. But we went without it there for about five innings, so we're just happy to have it now.
Maybe it's just because the sun was in it, we couldn't see it. Now we can with the sun going down.
That ball hit pretty hard, but a lot of air under it. Hit towards center field. I would call it medium depth center field. Put away out there, tagging up, and
pretty good hose.
Scoring pretty easily is going to be Grieshaber.
That ball was hit. Another line that you get from Major League where you say, where the guy's out in left field after the ball is just crushed, it's too high. It's going to be caught.
Right.
The ball just soars out of there. But you can tell when a ball has more height than distance. That ball had more height than distance.
Right. And there are just a few guys, big, strong, powerful guys that hit that ball, and there's another broken bat. Flies right out towards the pitcher's mound. Shortstop up with the ball over to first base. 6-3, that out recorded to end things here in the top half of the sixth. Who made that play out at short, Tom?
Well, it was Quentin Wahlberg.
He's been an impressive player in this game.
We've liked what we've seen from him. I didn't get the shortstop out there, though, unfortunately. There's our guy with the Missouri hat here coming to the dugout.
He is. That was our pitcher out there this past half inning.
So in the Columbia team, let's see if this all matches here. Brad Archer. Well, no, maybe that's not a Missouri hat. Brad Archer is a Missouri State signee. Mizzou and Missouri State, they tend to have some kind of raw feelings because Mizzou doesn't want to play Missouri State in non-conference basketball. It's kind of the same deal as KU and Wichita State.
Well, I tell you what, they haven't been what they've after the departure of Quanzo Martin. I wouldn't say went downhill, but they weren't quite at that level. It takes a new coach coming in, and I tell you what, I talked to Frank Haith. We did. We were both in Minden, Missouri, at the Tiger Caravan, and I mentioned something about Coach Haith. He was a great guy to talk to, but I mentioned something as people have made the comment, you know, the 30-5 season, that those weren't necessarily Coach Haith's players. And I understand what they're trying to say by that, but Coach Haith said, make no mistake about it, those are my players.
Exactly.
And he was pretty clear about it.
The story's pretty well known. If Missouri would not have brought in Frank Haith, for whatever reason, I think it's because when Frank was at Miami, he recruited Kim English. Kim English is pretty much, and I don't know the reason that there was so much enmity between Kimmy and Mike Anderson before he left for Arkansas, but Kim would not have come back for his senior year. He's told that to my face if they didn't hire Frank Haith.
And I'm sure you learned that about him during the barnstorming tour that they put on. There may have been another time, but I got a chance to meet Kim English too, and he was a great young man. And I'll tell you what, the guy that really impressed me off of a great career as a Tiger, had a season that went away because of injury. Lawrence Bowers, that's an impressive young man.
It is. He's going to play overseas, I believe, in Israel next year.
He will be in the NBA at some point.
You would think. It's hard to teach. It's hard to teach that ability with that height.
It is, and a lot of different things that Lawrence Bowers could do. Is, of course, I believe a Memphis, Tennessee native was.
In fact, I think he tried out this summer with the Grizzlies and. I think they realize, well, we don't have a spot on the squad for you, so, you know, play in Israel and more power to them.
Right, a lot of good overseas basketball, and they love guys over there. They love size in leagues, whether it be Europe or in Israel or which would be the Mediterranean, I guess, technically that would be. We won't get too geographical about it, but that one swung on and missed. The Mideast, I guess you would call it. But very good programs there and very good, very sound franchises. Love size.
I thought the Mideast was your Kentucky, Indiana region.
Right. It could be as well.
That's the Ohio.
And they know a little something about basketball there as well.
They do.
This game, 5-3. Columbia leads the Navy squad to get its all-star game. And I'm not sure how many times these kids have played together. They may have went around to different towns and had a chance to play once or twice. And certainly most of them have played against each other. But there's going to be certain things that require timing and having worked together for. We may see these kids struggle a little bit with that.
That's to be expected in an all-star game. The one thing with the Major League Baseball all-star game is you're dealing with a higher level athlete and also athletes that have played baseball for their whole lives, and particularly at the big league level for at least 3 months going into that game. So it's not as big of a jump. These kids are coming off playing more than likely some high school football here 48 hours ago, and I'll try and play some hardball.
Or some of these kids, I guarantee you, were playing some high school football. And if they weren't, we've got some coaches that are pretty distraught about it. Some good size. Like I said, there was a young man I was looking through my roster, 6'8", 265, I believe.
That's filling out the weight category right there. Isaiah Campbell doing the pitching here for Team Columbia. He is a Olathe South product, 4.0 GPA out of Olathe, Kansas, obviously. And he's one of the guys that's trying to impress here today, as he is unsigned for the collegiate level. He is a junior in high school. So a lot of the juniors who we see with ability, and we've seen a couple of them with really good-looking curveballs, they are specifically out here early junior year, still very young men, probably still 16. They're trying to just catch somebody's eye.
I'm dying to see some of these guys. There's a couple players that I looked at my roster. Of course, my hometown and very close to yours and a little bit north of the Kansas City area. The Grimacki kid from that ball hit hard to left field, and I think had the ability of getting out of here. Certainly hit far enough, but yanked foul, and that thing jumped off the bat.
Nick Perkins, if he straightens that out, that's heading toward a parking lot across the street. That's everybody driving by between here and Target. Watch out for that ball. You get your insurance guy out, because that ball was tattooed down the left field line.
That is absolutely right. That ball was hit hard. He ends up drawing a walk. I was mentioning some kids that kind of jumped off the page at me. One of them is Keaton Graff. I mentioned him from Santa Fe High School. He's a kid who I saw actually called a game of his. They were playing the Brunswick Wildcats at Kauffman Stadium here a few years ago when Keaton was a freshman. And I heard him popping the mitt clear from up in the public address booth there at Kauffman Stadium. I'm not sure if I know you've been in the broadcast booth there,
yeah,
but
yeah.
But that's a long ways away. You've got glass between you, and I could hear him popping the mitt through the glass as a freshman, and I knew he was something special then. Picked himself up a state title or two after that, but he's a kid who I'm just dying to see here. We have the Grimacki kid who's a played for the Smithfield Warriors in high school. He had a brother Eric Grimacki, who was, I believe, the quarterback there of the Smithfield Warriors, one of some very talented football teams. He's a nice player. And then you look at Jeremy Ironman, his brother, Johnny Ironman, out of Warsaw, came through the town of Warsaw today. The Wildcats, Johnny Ironman originally signed to play at LSU, then got drafted by the Tampa Bay Rays in the third round, and is currently involved in their system. Had a successful year, hit around 300, and I believe it was high A ball, so he's having an impressive time. And his brother, Jeremy, who's in this game here, has yet to enter the game, but is playing tonight. I'm really looking forward to seeing him play.
Seeing Isaiah Campbell here, just got himself a strikeout. I was just about to say he's scuffling a little bit, but as soon as I was ready to say that, the young man with the bat in his hands, he waved at an over-the-hand curveball, and that will bring for the Navy team to the plate. Another left-handed hitter, and Taylor Sanagorski, the future Wichita State Shocker.
The stretch, the pitch, Sanagorski takes it outside.
And the young man who tattooed that ball foul, the hardest hit ball we've seen tonight, bar none. This is where you start seeing the power of the SEC, too. You talk about the challenge of Missouri baseball and trying to compete in the SEC, maybe in more of a conversation on the baseball side than the football side, because after the game at Indiana last night, I'm kind of encouraged by Missouri football and the SEC this year, quite frankly, but that's another discussion for another day. But you look at the power in the SEC. You know, Nick Perkins, the guy who hit that long, hard foul, he's going to Ole Miss. That's a pretty good baseball program down there.
That, of course, South Carolina, tremendous baseball program.
Yeah.
Arkansas as well.
Well, you know, it's a great baseball program when I remember watching, I think it was ESPNU, they had South Carolina on in the spring, and they had Frank Martin, who had just been signed from Kansas State at the time. He said, you know, our goal right now, we're not going to be South Carolina football anytime soon, but we'd like to be more popular than the baseball team.
Right. Good luck with that right now.
Baseball's a big deal in Columbia, South Carolina.
It is, no doubt. That's a great part of the country. I've had the fortune of actually working in Anderson, South Carolina at one point, which is very close to the campus of Clemson, and not all that far from Columbia either. And it's a great part of the country. Rabid sports fans there.
If you got a chance, and I would love to, I have so many college football stadiums, that would be a bucket list for me. But watching the pregame for Georgia Clemson that first Saturday night of the football season, there's a fly ball left field, can of corn, catch made. And that's the third out. We'll just kind of keep this conversation going, but that Georgia-Clemson game where Clemson, I didn't realize they did this. Did you watch that game on ABC?
Where they come out and touch the rock?
Well, yeah, they came up, check. They all come in on about four buses that go really, really slow, about 5-10 miles per hour around the stadium. And Clemson, what, town of 20,000? So it's probably
something like that,
probably the size of Kirksville, Missouri, kind of give you some idea. And the fans are just going nuts, and the players in these buses are just going around the stadium, and then they'll pull on to the south side of the stadium. They all get off, and that place, just 85,000 fans, just that's college football at its best. They all touch the rock, as is tradition. They came down, and Brent Musburger called it back in the 80s, and he called it, again here this year, the most exciting 20 seconds in college football. The touching of Howard's Rock and the running down the hill by the Clemson Tigers.
Right. I have to agree, and I've been there. It's the place that I got goosebumps with you talking about it there.
Yeah.
That means you must have done a good job of talking about it.
Well, one of my favorite things to do, and this is just, you know, kind of one of the things you get when you're a geography nerd or places that you've never been and you get on the World Wide Web, go to Google Maps sometime and just you can take a look at all these satellite images. You literally look at Clemson, South Carolina, and there's a little lake on the northwest side of there, and it looks like a small little town, like I said, about the size of Kirksville, Missouri, and this college campus on there, you know, regular college campus that you'd see with, you know, tree-lined streets, everything, and that big, huge football stadium.
Right.
Right in the middle of this small little town.
Pretty awesome. I have driven by it. It's just one of those things. If you're a big sports fan, it moves you. You know, just yes. Going by the stadium and you know, thinking about all the tradition and everything there. I hate to say it, I was just in Lincoln recently. Mm-hmm. Drove by Memorial Stadium, and it gives you that same feel
yes,
when you go
does.
By there.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot of places that you like to go and say, and you wonder how many people are at an event like that because they really don't care who wins, but they just. They live off of the type of butterflies that you get from being at a big-time college event that you know that's important and people are watching.
That type of atmosphere, it does it for a lot of folks. And I tell you what, we're here in late September calling baseball, Community America Ballpark, Kansas City, Kansas. These Van Johnson players out here in the Get Hits All-Star Game, and these kids doing a great job. And I talked to you, we were talking on the phone on the way down, and we could play baseball in the middle of February. It wouldn't matter to me. Nah. If I get the opportunity to call some baseball, that's where I'm going to be, my friend.
If it's the middle of February, can we shut these windows in front of
us? I'd like to think so. You maybe get Jim Bly in here with a heater. But it's a great, I mean, whether you be media here, whether you're a fan, whether you're a player. I haven't been to the locker rooms here at Community America. I have a feeling they're probably pretty impressive for an independent league, minor league baseball team. These kids, I'm sure, are really enjoying their time here and, you know, dealing with the plush amenities that this stadium has to offer. I know they're pretty nice here. We couldn't be in a better spot to call the game, and the accommodations exceptional. All our equipment up and working, and as anybody who's worked in either large, small, or medium market radio, that's not always the case.
No, you work in small market radio, which both you and I have experience in doing. You end up in some places where you just want to take the athletic director and say, really?
Yes. And maybe take him by the ear when you do it.
Yeah. But we're always nice to the athletic directors because they know they're nice to us. So, but yeah, this is wonderful, and we'll kind of give you some T-Bones trivia here. Do you know where the Kansas City T-Bones came from?
In the Northern League.
It's the town I was born in. We'll put it that way. So it's up north.
Is it Duluth?
It is. It's the former Duluth Superior Dukes of the Northern League.
I did not know that. I've been to the lovely. I'll tell you what, that's a beautiful place there on Lake Superior.
Have you ever seen Wade Stadium? It's kind of a 1930s brick ballpark. But I tell you what, it's not downtown Duluth, which is right on Lake Superior. It's probably a good 3 or 4 miles down I-35. But if you get a cold, foggy night there, it can be July the 20th. And it can be about a 45-degree foggy night there. There's a little bleeder to left, right in front of the left fielder. Hits the glove, rolls to the line, and that'll be a leadoff double for Team Columbia as they look to add to a 5-3 lead here in the top of the seventh.
That was Fear with that double out into left. Is a bleeder. I like to say he dumped that one into left field.
So by any stretch of the imagination, the Kansas City T-Bones are getting a lot better weather here for summer baseball than they do on occasion down in Duluth, Minnesota, next to Lake Superior.
No doubt. And I learned a lot about lake effect, which is obviously going to be a thing there in Duluth. Lived in Chicago for a while, too, and dramatic what a body of water like that can do to the weather.
Grew up about 25 miles southwest of Duluth, but that's up and over the hill because there's a big hill that kind of collects all of the cold wind if it's coming off the lake, kind of San Francisco-like. They call it San Francisco of the Midwest. But I had orthodontic issues, as so many kids do in their teenage years. So I'd go downtown Duluth, and I think about once every couple of months, you'd go and have your appointment there, and there'd be plenty of days as we get a fly ball pop up in the infield, caught by the shortstop. Plenty of days, it'd be about 85, 90 degrees, a hot summer, humid day. You'd go down there and temperature drop about 40 degrees. You better make sure you have your coat in your back seat.
Better have a hoodie on or something.
Yeah. It's quite a ways north of here, and not quite the summer heat that you get in the great state of Kansas.
And for those of you who don't know, if you want to know what's north of Duluth, Minnesota, there's not anything there but Canada.
There's a North Shore.
I know. I bet.
and a lot of the towns up there that my high school played in basketball back in the day.
No doubt, and I had a great time when I was up there. And Lake Superior, I tell you what, an impressive body of water.
Yeah, it's you would think you're looking at the ocean, but it's a cold ocean.
Right, because I've been to Lake Erie, and by the other ones, Erie did not impress me and didn't give me the awe that Lake Superior did.
I like going to Chicago, going down to Lake Michigan, down there by the planetarium, I think it is, and all the different things they have down on the lakefront.
Right, they... There's a lot of good things. The Shedd Aquarium is down in that area. And, of course, you go, I think it'll be a little further south. Soldier Field, not very far away either.
Got that, yep. And now they have a new amp theater where they have all kinds of, concerts. I saw Kelly Clarkson there about 7-8 years ago down. It's east of Soldier Field down there on the, whatever they call it, body of water that goes out into the lake. I don't know what the correct term for that is. What is that, an isthmus or a peninsula? I
think I'm not gonna put myself out there to say for sure.
It's like a smaller Florida. I think it's a peninsula, but a very small one.
Right. Chicago, a great city. I lived there in the suburbs for a few years.
Fun. But if you don't like traffic, I don't know if I'd move there anytime soon.
Probably the worst in the country, to be quite honest about it.
Take the L.
And yes, and.
5-3 your score, and there's a foul ball coming back our way. You might have had a play at that one if it weren't for the screen.
I would have had it too. The reflexes somewhat still there.
Well, we have.
I don't have a hat on like normally. Normally, I like if they hit one my way, I'm not going to be the guy that barehands a line drive out of a game like this. I'm going to be the guy that uses my hat. That one hit foul over towards the first base side, and that one rattles around in the seats a little bit.
Nope.
Then gets chucked into the dugout.
I figured that they keep the baseballs as a souvenir if you get them tonight.
Try to, at least, anyway. They might send the goon squad up to get you. I've seen it happen in the...
That pitch was outside. It's waved at, and the catcher unable to get to the ball. So reaching first base on a swing and a miss, but a ball getting through the catcher for Team Columbia's run scores on the play.
Gianola.
Is Robinson Griffin. Let's go the other way. Griffin Robinson. So Robinson reaches first, and it was Gianola that scored.
Oh, that's Navy. I'm looking at the wrong roster.
Live broadcasting on the seat of your pants.
At least, you know, there's an ample seat of my pants, at least, anyway.
You mentioned that Jim Bly would bring us up a heater if we were broadcasting in February. Just that would be something to keep us warm and not as fastball.
Right.
Jim, we love you, but we think your fastball is highly hittable.
Well, he might beg to differ with you. I tell you what, for a guy of his advanced geriatric state, that guy can run pretty good.
That's a beautiful way of saying somebody's old, by the way.
Right, right.
That made my whole night. Advanced geriatric state.
Political correctness. I like to use it on the air, even though I may not use it when I'm off the air.
I would just say he has geriatrical issues.
That would work too.
Yeah.
Well, that's an impressive play.
Somebody gets spiked out there at second base. Second baseman for Team Navy's hobbling around.
5-4 that play at second base made.
Griffin Robinson, I beg your pardon. I was looking at the wrong team. I figure if you were going to do it once.
Right, just to make me feel better about myself.
Austin Gianola. I don't know if he took a spike in the ankle or something, but kind of hobbling around a little bit as we have a runner on first. And at two outs, 6-3 now to score. Run scoring for Team Columbia there on that wild pitch on the strikeout.
That one
hit the foot. Ouch.
It's unfortunate for the batter. Fortunate for him, though, he'll get another opportunity at it.
Let's mention this is a young man's name. First time we've seen Charlie Rona. W-R-O-N-A at the plate for Team Columbia. He's out of Broken Arrow, Oklahoma. Dated a girl from back there back about 10 years ago.
Really?
In the suburb of Tulsa. Yeah, long distance, like, you know how well they work.
Well, that's the great thing about Oklahoma is, though, they don't discriminate. They've got Broken Arrow, and they also have Broken Bow.
That's right.
If you're into archery in Oklahoma, you're in some trouble.
And they have Tulsa, which is just a lot easier to say.
Right.
Charlie is from Bishop Kelly High School, and he is a junior. So he's one of those juniors looking for a place to play here in a couple of years. Takes a fastball strike on the outside corner, and the count is 1-2, 6-3. Team Columbia leading Team Navy here from Community America Ballpark, Kansas City, Kansas, on 810 WHB-TV.
Tell you what, Blue behind the plate, doing a nice job out here. He's been consistent. He's been emphatic. He, although a little bit delayed, puts you in the mind of a guy. I guarantee you've called some games that he's interviewed one, Troy Figg. A little bit of a delayed call.
Exactly.
Always the correct call, but a little bit delayed.
You know what? We haven't criticized the umpire once in this game.
Oh, I'm going to have to work on that.
Well, sure sign that the guy's doing a good job. He's not getting his name mentioned.
Two broadcasters not talking about the home plate umpire and his strike zone. Very uncommon, but it means good things as far as the job he's doing behind the plate. 6-3, the Columbia squad leads the Navy squad here in the Get Hits All-Star Game. Rod Tompkins, Tom Johnson, proud to bring it to you right here on 810 WHB-TV. Kevontae Mitchell out of Kennett, Missouri, going to come to the plate here. Got a new pitcher, number 23 for the Columbia squad. Can you track that one down for me, my friend?
The number 23, Reese Edens, Blue Springs South product and a future Nebraska Cornhusker. And he might have everybody beat with GPA. No, he doesn't. He has one ahead of him on his squad, but his GPA is 4.11. That's nothing to sneeze at.
No, it is not. And we mentioned this is a showcase of athletic and academic ability here, the Get Hits All-Star Game.
If you can get players from the East Kansas City Metro, the Blue Springs, the Lee Summit, places like that, that's so heavily recruited. K-State, KU, Nebraska, Missouri, Arkansas, as we said, they like to get them in the Kansas City area. This is an area that even though Nebraska's in the Big Ten, they still recruit Kansas City Metro heavily.
No doubt. And you mentioned all that competition among some big schools, but a great D2 baseball, great NAIA baseball around this area as well.
Even at the JUCO level.
True.
You have Donnie Hillerman up there at North Central Missouri College and at Maple Woods. I believe that's where the grounder back to the pitcher and a throw to first for the out is doing the pitching is Reese Edens. I believe that's where Trenton native played, I think, for the Chillicothe Cardinal Summer League team this year in Austin Norris.
I think he's going to go back to Maple Woods. Hurt his arm a little bit last year, I know. Also the grandson of Mike Arbuckle, who we spoke about earlier.
Yeah, exactly. And I believe Austin, too, is... I want to say he was drafted in the 41st round a couple years ago by Philadelphia.
By the Phillies. Also, a Carrollton product left-hander who played JUCO ball for the Longview Lakers, Clint Culbertson's team. Now over with the Mules at UCM. Big, strong lefty, Zach Davis out of Carrollton, who I know you called some of his football games back on those great Carrollton teams that Coach Huff had whenever they'd come up and play Coach Croy and those guys. But Zach Davis, he was a kind of a setup man and middle reliever for the Mules this past season. They're looking to move him into the starting lineup, lengthen him out, and bottom line, he's a kid who I think will play Major League Baseball.
Yeah, there's a ground ball by Clayton Custer. Don't see a lot of guys in All-Star Game get four at-bats. Custer got that one in on the hands, and he just hit a little harmless one-hopper back to the pitcher for an easy 1-3 put-out. Two out, nobody on base for Team Navy here in the bottom of the seventh, and the Navy... Not the guys with the boats, but Team Navy in this situation. They need a comeback down 6-3.
That's right. And still a few players who we've yet to see in the game. We'll look forward as we got quite a bit of baseball left here. As, that may not have been Custer's Waterloo there, but it might have been his little bighorn that last pitch.
Not his last stand, though, right?
Exactly.
Austin Gianola at the plate.
That ball, I mean, shot into the crowd, foul and hard. I'm glad I wasn't down there.
Well, there's a lot of people here in the crowd that are dressed as empty seats tonight, but still for an All-Star game in the late fall months, good amount of folks here. I'd say anywhere 100 to 200 people.
Tell you what, that's scary right there. That's a foul ball that got into the crowd fast enough. Nobody could have reacted to it.
Right over the dugout, the ones you don't like.
I had a good looking fastball. Had to have missed just outside. I might take umbrage with that one if I was on the mound. Have you ever taken umbrage?
If I could throw like that, I wouldn't take umbrage to anything.
That was good looking. Now we've lost our radar gun. I guarantee you I'll put that fastball up at least mid-80s.
Catchers are having a tough time catching even almost as simple as the fastballs have been down. We've seen a ton of, we've seen at least three or four strike them out instead of throwing them out at first. Wild pitch gets away from the catcher. We've seen a lot of young men reach first base on plays like that tonight.
We have because we're, the things we're dealing with here is a different pitcher every inning. You don't know a guy's tendencies. You have guys who will go out there and who get by and by changing arm slots frequently and things like that can throw you off as a catcher. And so it is tough on these guys out here behind the plate. And as they'll only see a guy, like we said, for about an inning at a time, and that's got to be rough for them. We've seen a pitching change every inning, but we sure haven't seen a catching change.
Well, we just saw a walk. The potential tying run is in the on-deck circle as Dilday steps to the plate.
He's already got a triple here in this one. Waved at that pitch and missed as he took a little something off there with a changeup. Now we get a little radar gun action, 72-mile-an-hour changeup to start him off, and I think he was setting dead red on that one, was well out in front.
Mentioned Donnie Hillerman a couple minutes ago. He is with the JUCO program up at North Central Missouri College in Trenton, Missouri, where I work up that way for KTTN, KGOZ Radio, and I'd say, it's my job, so it's not my spare time, but it's what I do for a living. And He came from a Merrimack Community College in St. Louis. He raves about, and it starts with the Cardinals, but the baseball community and the talent in the St. Louis area. He swings away and misses at a low and inside pitch, strikes out, and that ends the seventh. 6-3 after seven, it's Team Columbia over Team Navy. Here from Community America Ballpark, Kansas City, Kansas, on 810 WHB TV. We're back after this.
Welcome back, 810 WHB-TV, Ask and Ye Shall Receive. We're going to get to see the...
You bragged up Keaton Graff earlier in the ballgame. We're going to see your guy here, the Waverly product out of Santa Fe High School. I guess it's Alma, Waverly, that area there, South Carrollton, along the Missouri River. That's the area he hails from.
That is absolutely correct. Good basketball player, plays for Travis Zoll on the basketball court. A solid basketball program there. And Keaton, his high school baseball coach, Josh Fisher, not just a coach, a friend of mine as well, a good guy, and he's had a great run there at Santa Fe. And look forward to watching Keaton. First time I've seen him pitch in about 2 or 3 years, and he has gotten much bigger. He is he's got kind of that, he's not nearly as big or old yet, but he's kind of got that look to him. You know he's going to throw a real heavy fastball, going to pitch downhill most of the time. And that right there, I'd probably have to make the argument, the best-looking fastball we've seen here tonight.
And he... I don't know, would you describe, I used the term burly earlier tonight, big burly right-hander?
Yeah, he's sturdily built.
Yeah.
Big, strong kid.
At the high school level, you're very careful about how you describe, especially when you're broadcasting female games.
Right.
They tend to be a little bit more, a little bit more cognizant of the way that you describe the human body, but, burly kind of works for him.
That looked like a good two-seam fastball there from Graff that time around. You're absolutely right about that. There are two things you can avoid by being correct about those things.
Indeed.
You don't get slapped and you keep your employment.
No. No, you can't use, you don't want to use the term big burly for when you're broadcasting girl sports.
Tell you what, the
you
second really...
go for that very well.
The second really good pitcher in the last couple years to come out of Santa Fe High School, his left-hand counterpart on the state championship team, Andrew Curry, big, strong lefty who, if that ball grounded out towards short, up with it, over to first. The throw a little low, a nice scoop over at first base. Who's flashing leather over there right now?
A little Missouri-Missouri battle there. Santa Fe High School against Columbia Hickman. And the future Louisville Cardinal Colby Fitch grounds that ball out to left field. That'll be a good confidence booster for the young man out of Santa Fe, the Chiefs.
That's right. Keaton Graff played a lot of baseball over the past few years. And
have they trademarked the term Zoll ball yet? Because I've heard that mentioned just a time or two.
Yes, you might have.
I've heard that. Yeah, Zoll ball.
I'll tell you what, Travis Zoll's big enough. He can have anything copyrighted or anything he wants. That's one big fella. Great guy. The only problem with him, where he attended college at.
I think I know what that means. Would that be
No, it's actually a great place. I spoke of it earlier. Lincoln's where he went to school.
I thought you were talking about the place about a half hour west of here.
Well, it's a good-looking curveball right there by Graff. Had his catcher a little bit crossed up.
That's okay if you do that with nobody on base.
Certainly the best time to do it if you're going to do it. Keaton Graff, the right-hander, and this game, 6-3. We haven't... had too much dramatic play here. Pretty sound, both these teams tonight. That one lined down the right field line. Going to be
foul by a foot.
If that even.
Yeah, maybe an inch. A lot of coaches up in Northwest Missouri with a Husker lean, I'd say, too.
That's
Greg
right.
Keith up at Polo High School. I know he's a big Husker lean.
Right. And I'm not sure where he went to college at, because I don't know. Did he go to the University of Nebraska?
No, I don't think so. He was an assistant with the women's program at NCMC in Trenton for a while, and then I think he got the job at Polo just from there. He probably been there about 5-6 years.
Right, doing a really nice job, coaching both boys and girls basketball there now. And
married a Missouri Tiger fan, so now they have two kids, and I think the agreement is the boy is going to be a Nebraska fan, the girl's going to be a Mizzou fan.
Well, that should be interesting.
It makes it a little bit easier with them in different conferences, though.
Yes, it does. trying to take some of the
house divided.
Yeah, the divisiveness of it is kind of taken away. That ball, two hopper to the second baseman. Over to first base that goes, 4-3. Coming in with that good heavy hard stuff, like I mentioned, getting a lot of ground balls is grabbed.
A descriptive word, because when you get that heavy sinker, that's when you hit that high chopping ground ball, as Connor Kaiser just did for Team Columbia. So Keaton has come in here. His goal, I'm sure his manager told him, go out there and keep us within three runs. And a couple outs, he's done that.
I believe this is going to be O'Brien coming to the plate here again, isn't it?
Yep.
Mason O'Brien.
He's hit the ball well tonight. He's going to do well in Stillwater for OSU.
I was mentioning Keaton Graff's high school teammate, a kid who's a year older than him, Andrew Curry, I believe went to Crowder. Don't quote me on that, Coach Fisher, if I'm wrong, I apologize. But he's another kid who has intentions of going to the University of Missouri, the last thing I heard. I know Keaton, they've been looking at him hard. Also recently debuted or showcased his wares for the New York Mets. We talked to their scout earlier, well aware of Keaton, told us a little bit about the things he brings to the table, which I was somewhat aware of, and got even more details from him. Had a fastball that misses high and away from Graff. But, you know, to have two kids like that of that caliber, you know, speaks for their talents. Also speaks to the importance of tradition, youth programs, and if you hail from that Alma area, that one back up the middle, Keaton couldn't do anything but jump out of the way of it, couldn't get a glove to it, and that one right back through the box, couldn't get it more back through the box than that one.
No, you don't want to get a bruise in an All-Star game going back to school next week. Did you happen to see the line drive that James Shields had hit back at him today?
No, I did not. I heard about it. Went off his elbow, didn't it?
Yes, tip of the elbow. Literally came back, and he cringed, as you do, kind of pulled his arms in because he knew he was going to take a shot. It literally hit, and I'd never seen this in the super slow-mo cam on the broadcast. Hit him on the tip of the elbow, and one coming back about 130 miles an hour, hit you at the tip of the elbow. That's going to hurt.
No doubt about it, and he gutted his way out. Big game, James. One tough character.
Through, I think it was 9 innings, maybe 8. Not
I
sure
think it was 8,
part.
Actually.
I can tell you it was shut out, though, because that was a 4-0 Royals victory. Grand slam, bottom of the 10th by Justin Maxwell. Quite a way to end the home slate.
Made it all worth the trade right there.
Guaranteed a winning season for the first time since 03.
Well, what a great first half of the year that one was.
You know, it's a frustrating thing for a Royals fan. Where would they be if it wasn't for that May where they went about 5-20?
No doubt.
That kills you.
See, I believe a 12-game losing streak at home early in the season this year.
Right.
Ball lifted, foul, down the right field line, well back out of play. Well,
certainly, when the ball hits the top of the roof in the metal, it doesn't make a very soft sound, does it?
I'm sure the folks are hearing that pretty well, I would judge. Rod Tompkins, Tom Johnson, we were told this game going to be a little more abbreviated than it was initially slated to be. They were going to go 12, and they've kind of sped things up for the pitcher's sake, from what we understand. Going to go 9 innings, I believe, now.
I think they were just playing with us, having us come in here about 45 minutes before the game and telling us you're doing 12 innings.
Right, a little.
Seeing how we react.
Trying to see how we handle the on-the-fly nature of things when we're broadcasting.
I just would have said, is there any extra pay for 3 extra innings?
Right, and How many Brinks trucks are we going to bring in for our lofty pay?
Rod and Tom's Sunday Night Haul is what we're going to call it. There's a wild pitch inside, so young Mr. Keaton Graff, he walks another guy.
Little Nancy Sinatra there, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. And he has a first and second two-out jam to make his way through here. Is Ryan Ralston out of Blue Valley West High School here in Overland Park, and Mackin Sight steps in, big, strong, right-handed hitter for Team Columbia.
Keaton Graff got his first two outs pretty easily. Now he's got a pair of runners on after a single for the first base runner here in the inning. Ryan Ralston, that's a great baseball name, by the way.
It is. It is. That would be a St. Louis name, I think, with Ralston Perina in the coin that they have on the eastern side of the state of Missouri. 85-mile-per-hour fastball. I'm trying to figure out where it missed. Must have been outside this one, an 85-mile-per-hour fastball up and in. So Keaton's struggling to find the zone here, trying to keep his team within three.
And we know he's got a little more pop in that right arm than the 85. I was talking with Mr. Gossett, the scout of the New York Mets. He is consistent. That one at 86 now. It's pretty tough to come in and get lengthened out and throw in your best fastball. I would say Keaton, they would probably hadn't been throwing a lot of bullpens or anything recently like that. And I don't know when his last competitive game was, but he's got it up to 86 so far here, and he's a consistent 90-plus guy from what I understand for the most part.
You got to kind of warm up the arm to get it there, and they really, as you said, they haven't done a lot of competitive baseball here, at least over the last 5 to 6 weeks. So it's not something that you just kind of, you know, throw the ball and get it to where you want to. You usually have to work at that for a good couple of days.
Right. They might get out there, you know, prior to a start or something, throw some long toss and do some things like that that would really get them ready for it. But in this case, coming out of the bullpen, it's a different deal. That one misses down and in.
Scouts are kind of, this is where the scouts are looking specifically for. You're in a jam. Some of it's from your own doing. Some of it's a little bit bad luck. But how do you respond? How do you work yourself out of a first and second two-out jam?
How do you use those physical tools coupled with your mental makeup to get out of this?
Probably more looking at the mental makeup. Good pitch right in on the hands of the right-handed hitter. Squibbed off to the left side and foul. And we got ourselves a little situation here. 3-2, two outs, two on. 6-3 of the score with Columbia looking to add on some runs here on the top of the eighth.
Runner's going to be in motion here with the full count and two down. Keaton Graff looks in, gets a sign from his catcher. Comes set just above the belt and deals. Breaking ball, misses down and away, ball four. I'll tell you what, says a little something about the confidence to come with the breaking ball there.
It's a wonderful pitch, that breaking ball on 3-2, if you can spot it. It also says a lot to the scout if you can spot the 3-2 pitch and get a swing and a miss, but that was not a very good-looking breaking ball, so it's now bases loaded and two outs and trying to put a big hole in the dam here for Team Columbia and open up this three-run lead is Brett Fair.
That would have been a slider there from Graff that last time. That's a fastball, and that was right down the middle. Took a little something off, though, as we've seen him up in the high 80s, that time down around 81, and showing his experience and kind of his finesse in barely changing speeds like that. The best in the game, that's the things they're able to do.
It's a high fastball waved at by Fear. He's going to Wichita State. Kind of surprising because you'd figure he's a K-State guy. He's from Manhattan.
Right. They went over and worked him over and got him to Wichita.
Probably a better, although K-State had a great baseball season last year, traditionally Wichita State has been the best baseball program in the Sunflower State. There's a ground ball right back to the pitcher. One hopper tossed over to a first base, and your guy got out of the jam.
Got out of the jam, didn't give up a run. Had one back through the box he couldn't glove. He gloved that one on a pretty well-hit ball. Tosses it over to first, 1-3, the final out recorded in the top half. And we're going to take a little break, come back the other side with what I believe to be the bottom of the eighth, I believe it's going to be. And we'll be back with more right after this here on 810 WHB-TV. We're in the bottom of the eighth here at Community America Ballpark, the Get Hits All-Star Game.
We don't necessarily root in this game, but I wouldn't mind to see a little rally here by the Navy squad down 6-3, maybe get some ninth inning excitement going.
That sounds good to me. They've struggled a little bit at the plate. Pair of hits, that's all they got them down for.
Pretty odd to see 3-2-0. Hard to get three runs with only two base hits.
That is a fact.
Now pitching for Team Columbia, Nolan Gromacki, Smithville Warrior product from just up the road with a 4.0 GPA, and he is a senior at Smithville, so he would really like to find somewhere to pitch next year.
That ball hit hard to right center field, but
more high than far.
Right, I think the air a little bit heavier now than it was earlier this evening. That ball sure seemed like it was hit better than that.
Now, you wonder how much off their game the hitters are, too, because we've seen a couple of hard hit balls, but nothing really that scares you as the pitcher. And as we said earlier in the ball game, if you're not familiar with some of the dimensions at Community America Ballpark, from the left field line to straightaway left into left center was 347. That's pretty inviting out there, and nobody's threatened that wall.
No, nothing's been hit hard that direction. The hardest hit ball we've seen was a foul ball, of course.
And it was hit a mile far over the line in Kugel's. And Dan out there.
You're making me thirsty now.
Me too.
Gromacki, the Nolan variety. I mentioned what I believe to be brother Eric was a very good athlete at Smithville High School. They put out some good baseball players over the years. Eric, then Nolan Gromacki here, and young man, a good pitcher by the name of Reese Ponak, I had the fortune of seeing here a year or two ago. I believe he's playing for the Mules down at UCM as well.
And a pretty good football, basketball athlete from about 6-7 years ago named Andrew Jones.
Played at the University of Missouri, of course.
And he played both sports. He didn't play a lot of basketball senior year, but he was on the squad, and he didn't embarrass himself when he got out there against Big 12 competition.
And wasn't nobody going to take it away from him out there either.
No. So it's bad. You can tell when somebody has lifted weights in Coach Pinkel's program. They look a little bit different after 4 years. I ran into Brad Madison, who was with the Chiefs in a training camp, and got pretty close to getting himself a practice squad spot, but he was up at a jamboree up at his alma mater at South Harrison High School up I-35 in Bethany. And, boy, yeah, he can fill out a uniform. He's a good, solid 275.
He sure can. I wouldn't have surprised me if he could have played some Division I basketball himself either. He was a very talented basketball player.
One of two Madisons to play at the University of Missouri.
Good-looking fastball there from Gromacki. Misses outside, 82 mile an hour.
You kind of look at a fastball like that, too, and you say, that didn't hit the corner. Sure looked like it did from my angle. Maybe it was low.
Of course, the man behind the plate, about 4 feet away from the action. We're about, 200.
How many Major League umpires do you think have told the managers down through the years, sir, my opinion is the only one that matters. Your opinion means nothing to me.
That's right. I tell you what, especially when you're talking youth-type baseball, these guys, none of them out here doing it to get rich. They're all out here doing it. They love coming out here, and of course they make the little bit of money. They like the little bit of money they make from it, but they're out here. They love being around the kids. They love doing being a positive influence in these kids' lives, and have a lot of fun doing it. My grandfather, longtime coach, longtime umpire, my broadcast partner. I don't know if you knew this, Chuck Haney, a long time umpire, and I'd hate to give him too much credit, but he's a pretty good one too.
He's not a bad public address announcer either.
He does a good job at that. Does a lot of good things.
He's also a mayor of a pretty good-sized town in north central Missouri.
And I think opinions might vary on that part. No, I'm just kidding. That's my buddy Chuck. But I tell you what, anytime you're holding down public office, you are wide open for
praise,
fervent public opinion.
Praise and criticism.
Yes.
Talk to Obama about that one.
He's got a pretty thick skin, our old buddy Chuck does.
He does. He does.
He's probably just from being old that it's tough. But
now, if we're going to insult our buddy Jim Bly for being geriatrically challenged.
Well, I'm not sure what that would make Chuck. I would mention Chuck, also a Missouri Press Hall of Famer as well. Boy, that's a good-looking fastball. Better sounding.
Long time at many, many stations across north central Missouri, but really one of the voices of high school sports as far as post-game scoreboard shows.
That's right. Gave me my start back in the day. Had a breaking ball.
You tend to suck up to people like that.
Right, I do. Got to respect the elders. And Chuck got a lot of talent. And I'll tell you what, he serves the city and serves the youth and a lot of folks around the area, does it tirelessly and selflessly, I'd have to say, as well.
There's a strike three looking with a notion, not able to pull the trigger there, was Nick Perkins, the catcher out of Francis Howell High School. So he's caught looking, and that will bring to the plate for Team Navy here at the All-Star Game in KCK. Nick Roark, he's out of Broken Arrow, Oklahoma, and a senior this year at Broken Arrow High School. Lashes this one foul. That might hit the light standard there over the third base dugout. Well over the third base dugout. That's out there in the parking lot.
Lash, a nice description of that particular one as well, Monty.
Don't call me the best color man in the league for nothing. There's a lot. I'll read occasionally the Facebook posts or the YouTube videos from that movie. They say Monty has the best job ever. He gets to watch baseball and not say a thing the whole summer.
I like that. The first two good movies. After that, it got a little rough.
They're talking about a Major League 3. I read this. I guess it probably was on Wikipedia.
I thought we already had a 3. See, that shows how much I know.
Al? I think there was a Major League back to the minors or something like that they had with, like, the Salt Lake Bees. But this would be a Major League 3 with a lot of the original characters, and it would have Charlie Sheen, the Wild Thing. He would be kind of a mentor to one of the young pitchers.
That's frightening.
Yeah. Both ways. Either as Charlie himself.
Or as the Wild Thing, yeah.
Or as Ricky Vaughn.
Yep. I'm trying to think of, there were some awful good actors in those. I liked some Pedro Serrano. He was a great character on that team.
Now the All-State guy.
Yes, that's right. Dennis Haysbert, I believe his name.
You are correct.
Yeah. Now, we hear this phrase commonly in our profession, the voice of God. Now, Dennis Haysbert has it.
He does.
As I would imagine it, at least, anyway. Him and George Burns back in the day. Of course, he got the part, too, so.
Who's the actor who is the voice of Chef on South Park? Passed away 7-8 years ago?
I should know, but I don't.
He had the voice of God, too.
There's some great pipes out there in the business. And there's a little Nancy Sinatra music for you again.
You know who would absolutely, though, if you're talking the voice of God from just a voice? Bob Shepard. The late public address announcer at Yankee Stadium.
Love him. That's the way you do public address.
And the fact
in baseball, at
the
least.
The fact that they have a recording of him, number two, shortstop, Derek Jeter, number two.
Jeter.
Yeah, Jeter. And he wasn't flashy.
I believe that to be the way baseball public address is to be done.
Exactly.
That is 100% class.
Well, and I regret not seeing a game in the old Yankee Stadium, to be honest, because that's a cathedral to baseball. It's not there anymore.
That ball hit hard, right center field, into the gap, but cut off. Impressive play to get there, but it still drives in a run.
Here comes the Navy. It's 6-4.
Two, as a matter of fact.
That's going to score at least one. Was it two? Yep.
Two.
Two. Two across.
I didn't mean to step on your feet there, sir.
No, that's okay. I was screwing up a call.
Well, I can do that anytime.
Yeah, as a color analyst, you're supposed to screw it up, and I'm supposed to correct you. We got it backwards.
We've been doing a little bit of both of us here tonight. It's a little bit more fun that way.
That ball was ripped. First and third, tying run at third. Two outs. We got a situation here in the bottom of the eighth.
Kevonte Mitchell out of Kennett, Missouri, comes to the plate. What are his collegiate ties? Does he have them?
Well, we're going to find that out here in a little bit. Mitchell has collegiate ties to nobody. He is a senior down at Kennett High School. And, Indians, I think. Kennett Indians sounds right.
Your guess is probably better than mine.
We don't exactly cover the boot heel very closely.
No, we don't. We were pretty aware of not the boot heel, of course. Well, the boot heel area, but the guys out of the Sykeston area, Scott County Central,
we know
they're the Braves.
Well, and I can tell you this, too. I saw, is it Charleston that played in Columbia, I want to say, 2 years ago and won one state, and I think that's where stud for Mizzou back in the 80s, Ricky Frazier.
I was getting ready to say that.
Yeah, he was good.
One of my favorite players. Has a lot of great ones, of course, the guys you've heard of, the John Sunvolds, the Steve Stepanoviches, the Rushes, and the Anthony Peelers, guys like that. There were some other guys, a JUCO transfer out of Moberly Junior College, Malcolm Thomas, who was a stud for the Tigers back in the day, too.
That Moberly to Columbia pipeline's kind of dried up in recent years. For whatever reason, I'm not sure why, but I know just from kind of reading different recruiting blogs and whatnot that there's a, I want to say, a point guard at State Fair that Coach Haith is looking at kind of closely.
And I know Brennan Hughes out of the Moberly area played for the Spartans, was back at Moberly Area Community College, and there was certainly a time when the Tigers were looking at him as well. That ball lifted out towards first base foul territory.
Foul ball out. Caught, and it stays 6-5. Hey, well, you know what? We were kind of rooting for a little rally there by the Navy squad. They get two, and it's 6-5 going to the ninth. We should have a tremendous ninth inning. We're not 100% sure a game's going to go nine, but I'd kind of be in favor of that because we got a nice, close, tight ball game at this point. We'll be back after this on WHB 810 TV.
We're back here, Rod Tompkins, Tom Johnson in the booth at Community America Ballpark, the Get Hits All-Star Game. We understand this is probably going to be the last inning here as the Columbia squad. I got fooled by the pitcher. I was looking at the pitcher. He's got on that light blue uniform, which is the Columbia squad, but he's out there playing for the Navy squad. These guys are confusing me.
Is it kind of one of those deals you'll see on these reality TV shows once in a while where they'll switch up teams just to make things interesting by the end of the game?
That's what they're doing. It may be a matter of they want to make sure every kid got some work here in front of the scouts, too. It could be what happened. Obviously, the focus of this game to showcase these kids, get them looks by scouts, whether they're pro, college, or whatever, that maybe have not signed. That ball absolutely ripped to left center field, but it's put away right at the warning track, about 340 feet, I'd guess, out there.
He got under that one because 352 is reachable. He got under that ball instead of driving that ball, and we've seen that as a kind of consistent theme here tonight.
little smile on his face. He knows he got most of that one, but it just missed.
Just missed, exactly. Who just missed that ball? Tanner Gregg out of Overland Park. He got a high, majestic fly ball, and if he hits that one a little bit more square, he drives it over the Buck O'Neill sign at 352.
I'll be honest, off the bat, I thought it was gone.
The sound sounded good off the bat. That's what a lot of broadcasters go by, too. You don't look at you're listening for the sound off the bat.
It was, and that one had a beautiful sound to it, but again, a little heavier air than we had earlier in the day. Good breaking ball that just misses off the inside edge.
No humidity in the air, though. It's a beautiful night. I don't think there's much. Now there is a little bit of a breeze. Still kind of blowing from the right field corner out toward left. Just enough to keep the flag flapping out there in the bullpen.
Had another breaking pitch that's fouled away at the plate.
Griffin Robinson up. Let's tell you about this pitcher. He's pitching for Team Navy, although he has a Columbia blue on.
And is that Rourke?
I'm looking for number six. I don't see a number six. Up there is Ryan Watkins out of Kearney, Missouri. Going to Drury University down in Springfield.
Good baseball program there.
Good basketball program, D2 national champions. I think the Bearcats Northwest opened their season down there.
Play their baseball there at Metter Park, where we've had many state championship games played, and that's an awesome field right there. A little big for my taste for high school baseball, but they play it there, and it's when it comes to a MISHA event, which for folks that don't know, the Missouri State High School Activities Association. From a broadcasting perspective or as a fan, the ability and the access directly to the stadium and the seating and the parking, everything in very close proximity, a very good event, very well run, and a great place to go broadcast and watch baseball. But I love the old-time feel also to Metter Park. Has the little trail between the pitcher's mound and home plate, which is a very 20s, 30s yeah. type of thing. And
see that in Detroit and Arizona in the big leagues, and I think that's it.
Not very many of them.
No. And I'm partial to kind of smaller dimensions. The big walls like we have here at Community America Ballpark down the left field line, at least at the high school level. You know, if you hit a ball well, you like think you got a chance to maybe hit it out or at least hit it off the wall and get some excitement going.
Absolutely right.
Exactly.
We're going to be joined here in a matter of seconds by a guest.
As the pitch is swung on and missed, and we're going to the bottom of the ninth inning, Ryan Ralston. Swings away and misses on that pitch and going to the bottom of the ninth as we're joined by a special guest here in the booth on 810WHBTV.com. It is 6-5, Team Columbia over Team Navy. And Team Navy is going to bring to the plate here to begin what they hope is going to be a little rally here in the bottom of the ninth out of Mill Valley High School, Shawnee, Kansas, and the Kansas City Barnstormers. Number 30 in Grayson Genista, J-E-N-I-S-T-A. I hope that pronounced that right. If not, I apologize to the Genista family.
And we're going to jump straight into an interview here. Carl Carswell, who's a scout with the White Sox, also the director and kind of organizer of this Get Hits All-Star event. Carl, thanks a lot for joining us.
Hey, thanks for having me.
And I tell you what, we've seen some impressive athletes out here already this evening. Some of these kids I was familiar with, as Tom and I both come from a little bit north of this area, north of the Kansas City area. But kids like Keaton Graff and the Grimacki kid out of Smithville, we're real familiar with. But I'm impressed just with the way these kids are out here handling themselves, representing themselves. And we noticed, too, that one of the big things we wanted to point out, you mentioned Get Hits, a lot of the things here, the emphasis on academics and success in high school and everything like that. We noticed the cap and gown as part of the logo and everything like that. Not only are these kids great athletes, as we look down through the roster, these kids, they're smart.
Yeah, these kids are tremendous students. They one of our goals with Get Hits for Education is to identify athletes who have the ability to achieve high goals through their education. And the goal is to get college graduates and help them become really quality young men and baseball players. And these guys have the ability to go as far as they want to based on their athletic ability as well as their academic ability. And we really push to make sure they understand that and they have a great platform to go forward with that. And as you can see from our roster, we have kids committed to Nebraska and Wichita State, Kansas State. And this is early commitments because of their abilities in the classroom. And You can't go to college without that.
Right, and Tom and I talked a little bit earlier. Of course, these kids, their athletic abilities speak for themselves out here, but that ability in the classroom with you know, ACT scores in the 30s and things like that we're seeing, and high GPAs, there are guys that maybe might be a little bit borderline when it comes to baseball talent, but teams, you know, college is eager to sign them because they've got those academics and a strong work ethic and things like that, but allow them maybe to sign a guy over here who is a little bit more baseball oriented. But when you got a guy who's also successful in the classroom, oftentimes going to get a scholarship that way, be able to come in and play, and kind of expands and helps develop programs.
That's right. Because of the NCAA and the way it works in baseball, there's only 11.7 scholarships for 28 to 33 players. So when they can get academic scholarships, it really helps them to develop their roster in a way that allows them to give some more money to somebody who may not be as academic but is very good athletically, to a young man who is very good academically and may need to work for a year or two to get caught up athletically, and it's turned out really well for him.
Get caught up on the action here on the field. Sorry, guys. Austin Hansen is doing the pitching here for Team Columbia, and Grayson Janista, it's 1-2, and waves at an off-speed pitch, and it's one up, one down here at the bottom of the ninth.
And thank you very much for that, Tom. We've ended up in an exciting ball game here too, Carl. 6-5 it is. We saw an early 3-0 lead, but that got erased. The only thing that we've seen, kids maybe have a little bit of a rough time. These guys don't play with each other a lot. They're from different Ben Johnson teams, would it be, around the area? Is that correct?
It would be more of a high school local showcase teams, different types of teams, like would you be the Kansas City Barnstormers or the Building Champions or Mackensites, those type of teams. But they're from five different states, so some of these kids have never even seen each other before. And I've seen the rust on the defensive side where they're not able to make plays, maybe because of communication that they would be able to make generally all the time. And you see some rust at the plate because the pitching is so much of a high quality. Every pitcher, you know, in a traditional game, you get to the bullpen and maybe the pitcher's not as good as the starter, but in this situation, each pitcher's pitching one inning. They have their best stuff for an inning, so it puts a lot of pressure on the hitters.
It puts a lot of pressure on the catcher. These guys out here for all nine innings, you got a new guy coming in, don't know whether he's a guy who changes arm slots, or you maybe see some cross-ups on signals and things like that. The catchers, they really got their work cut out for them in this one.
Yes, they do, and we're really fortunate. We have nine quality catchers, six quality catchers, all six of which are Division I talented catchers, but catching a new pitcher every time with different arm angles and different types of breaking balls and the high velocity that these guys throw with is very challenging for these catchers.
As I was looking down through rosters, of course, kids with great names and names we recognize, like Jeremy Ironman, who's a kid who comes from Warsaw, Missouri. His brother Johnny, I believe, a third-round draft pick from the Tampa Bay Rays. I haven't seen Jeremy yet, been talking to a few people here and things. Is he here this evening, do you know? Or
Jeremy could not make it. He was a last-minute scratch. He got a concussion in the football game on Friday night, and one of our tough roles putting this roster together is that the players do play football, and you don't know what you're going to get until Saturday morning. And hit a concussion. He passed all the tests with the exception of being able to remember the game. He didn't get to make it. But, yeah, him and his brother, both Johnny, are both talented young men.
I know Johnny, I believe, seems like he was a quarterback there at Warsaw. Randy Murrow, their head football coach there with the Warsaw Wildcats. And father, a major league pedigree there too, isn't that correct?
Yep. I spoke with John this morning or yesterday morning, and he did play in the big leagues, or play in the professional baseball at least. And he also coaches their summer league baseball as well, and their high school baseball team does a great job.
Absolutely. I was down south in Bolivar, Missouri today, traveled back through Warsaw on the way, so I just wanted to throw that out there. And I knew he was a kid who has a really high ceiling from everything I understand.
Yeah, he's a baseball player. He's not a guy that you would say has all the greatest tools in the world, but he just loves to play the game. He plays very hard. He's really good at what he does. He catches the ball well, he runs well, and he handles the bat extremely well.
Young man out here at first base, Clayton Custer. He's the only guy on our roster here that you mentioned is going to play basketball at a pretty high level at Iowa State, and he's had a good night tonight.
Yeah, Clayton's a very good player and really intriguing to the scouts because of his athletic ability. Very interested in seeing what he could do as a baseball player full-time, but, you know, he's got a big decision. He's going to Iowa State to play basketball, and do you turn down that great opportunity to play such an intimate sport like basketball and everybody's crowded around and chasing it, or do you try to go play baseball and see how good you can come at that game? And I don't envy him for the decision he has to make.
It's still a nice decision to have to make, though.
Most definitely. Life's about choices.
I know which way Coach Hoiberg would like him to choose, though.
For sure.
I'm sure that's the case. And it's interesting to have you in here, both as a guy who organizes and directs this game. Tell us a little bit about the background of Get Hits and how this all got started and what goes on with that.
Well, as being the founder and owner of Barnstormers Baseball, we've been doing showcase teams since 1996. And early on in that part of our career, we knew we were interested in kind of selling the dream to our players of education first. And so we put together this nonprofit, Get Hits for Education, with the goal of making sure that we let our young players, our 7th, 8th grade players, understand that, hey, your freshman year, your GPA in college is, or in high school is the most important year. Trying to carry a 4.0 early gives you the opportunity to have a 4.0 late. You know, as soon as you lose your 4.0, you never get that back. So we've been really driving that home to our young players, and then we start expanding on that because of my professional scouting background. There's things like the area code games on the West Coast and East Coast Pro on the East Coast, which is similar to this. They're trying to bring the top layer level players together from their area for that. We decided we're going to do that here. So for the last 3 years, we've been doing it here, and we had 50 scouts pre-registered today to show up, and we had 25 college coaches. So the turnout's been tremendous for our area, and it's because we have such quality, high-quality players on the field.
You got a 6-5 game here, guys, and at the plate, it's Elijah Dilday, and Clayton Custer's out at second. These are a couple of guys for the Navy team that they've done some damage, both with their feet, as is the case for Custer, and Dilday hit a shot, maybe the hardest hit ball of the day.
Hardest hit fair ball, anyway.
Yeah. Hardest one that counts back in the third inning.
Yeah, Elijah Dilday is probably the most talented, gifted player on the field. He can run. He's got power. He's really aggressive. He's been an infielder all the way through his high school career, and he's after he committed to Nebraska, became an outfielder every day. And as you've seen him on the bases today, he's got incredible instincts, great speed. He's super aggressive. He's the kind of player you want to get out, see him play as a young player against really high-level players.
He gets a base hit here. We go extra innings maybe, or at least bottom of the ninth.
We'll see
Hey, fouls it at the plate.
We don't have enough pitching to go extra innings, so if it's a tie, we're going to kiss our sister.
we're gonna end it right there then, if that's the case. I know paramount, you know, taking care of these kids. Like I was mentioning to Tom earlier, Custer, I'm sure Iowa State Coach Hoiberg probably not all that excited he's out here playing in this game, but he's a kid with a big decision coming up, and, you know, athletes – you know, they like to be on the field to play, whether it's their favorite one or their one that they're the best at. They just like to be out here competing.
That's right. Most college coaches and professional scouts, as well as just people who are really into sports, like guys who play multiple sports. They like to see them out competing and see how they use their athleticism different ways. So I bet Coach Custer would probably be out here rooting them on.
That's right. Hey, since you have the professional scouting background with the White Sox and everything like that, we talked a little bit pregame here. The one thing, of course, that you hear about every pro tryout, speed. You know, they're going to go guys out. They may run foul line to foul line. They may run 60s. They may do whatever. That's one thing you can't coach into kids. So we talked about how maybe it's hard sometimes for a guy who's, pitchers, catchers, they may get excluded from that a little bit. But a guy who can really swing the bat, sometimes it may take a little bit extra time for him to get discovered.
That's exactly right. Speed is something that helps guys who don't hit as well as they'd like to or aren't hitting as well as they'd like to turn outs into hits. And
high fly ball right field, that's going to be in the park by Dilday. He got under that one, and the ball is caught out in right field, and that's going to do it. 6-5 Columbia with the win. And I tell you what, Dilday got a pitch to his liking. He just missed that baseball.
No doubt about it. Hey, Carl Carswell, has joined us here. He's the director of the Get Hits All-Star Game for Education, also a scout for the White Sox. Carl, it's been fun talking to you. We love talking to great baseball guys, and believe me, guys that are scouting for the major leagues know a whole lot about baseball. We enjoy, Tom and I, we get to talk with Mike Arbuckle, senior advisor to Royals general manager Dayton Moore. We get to talk to him a lot, broadcast a lot of his grandson's games and things like that. Love having a great baseball guy around like yourself or Mr. Arbuckle, people like that, because I tell you what, anytime that Tom and I can come out here broadcast baseball, we feel like we're stealing money almost.
You might be. Just like I feel like I'm stealing for going out and watching games. So I love Mr. Arbuckle. He's been a tremendous influence on my career. He does a great job and doing wonderful things for the Royals right now. So.
Say this about the White Sox, too. I know Royals fans might not agree with this, but the Central Division more fun when Chicago's good.
There's kind no doubt.
That big city team.
Especially for Carl at this point.
Yeah, exactly.
There's
but
no
the,
doubt.
The big city team you're trying to knock off the pedestal, though. And I know it's been a rough year for the Southsiders.
Well, when the Central Division is strong, baseball's a lot more exciting.
Yes.
And it doesn't matter that, you know, yeah, we all want to win it, but just when it's good and everybody's doing well, it's much more fun beating up on teams that are good than it is beating up on
them. It's completely flipped, too. 5 years ago, it was the Twins and the White Sox was a huge rivalry, and now those teams have had really poor years, and you have the Indians, the Tigers, and the Royals really coming on.
That's exactly right.
Hello. We don't want to go compare payrolls there between, say, the Tigers and the Royals, though, or anything like that. But, of course, Tom, you might be able to pick it up, Carl. His background up a little bit north. You can pick up that Minnesota in his talk,
can't
you?
Yeah, I can hear a little bit of that.
I thought you might be able to.
You know what that's called? That's called the North of 90 accent.
The North of 90 accent. See, I learned something every broadcast here.
90 runs from Sioux Falls over to middle of Wisconsin, so
Is this the only time, Carl, these kids will play together then is in this one game like this? I know they play against each other some here and there.
This is the only time that they'll play together. We put this on once a year, and we're able to invite all the players. So it's been five states this year. So we've got Nebraska, Missouri, Kansas, Oklahoma, and Illinois, and hoping to add Arkansas next year.
That'd be awesome. A lot of great baseball there, and we'll look forward to maybe coming back next year. It's going to be on my plans at least anyway, and next year we'll get you up here for a few innings, make you tag along with us here, and give us some insight. Really interested to kind of look into the mind of a Major League scout. Because like I say, a background in baseball, my grandfather, a longtime coach and things like that, so I like the little nuances of baseball. I was going to ask you earlier, and I'll give you a chance now, what are some of the things besides the obvious, besides the speed, besides the power, a really live arm and things like that, some of the things that may not go noticed by the average person that guys like yourself are looking for in a kid?
The hardest thing to really understand is a player's heart and how hard they want to work at the game, and you just don't ever know that until you get them out into either college or professional ball and have them play. And that's why we do so many of these different showcases now, and there's so many teams out there playing, is to give us the opportunity to find out, okay, is this a kid who's going to do the work? Just like your task, your craft here, you guys have worked years and years at being able to look at a roster and see the game and be able to talk about it, communicate in a way that people understand what you're doing. The same thing has to happen in baseball. You have to get out there and really hone your craft. Hitting is such a hard skill. Being able to throw that ball through the strike zone where you want to and how you want to with the speed you want is a hard skill. And so are kids willing to really work at it? That's the question we have to answer.
From a White Sox perspective, it's been such a power team. You know, the Canerkos and the Adam Dunns and guys like that. You know, you sit back and you wait for the three-run home run. And I know one of the things that, you know, I watch Hawk Harrelson on the broadcast every once in a while, and he will talk about that going forward, that I think Kenny Williams is your GM, really wants to increase the speed and kind of get back to the go-go White Sox from back way back in the day. But is that something that's really first and foremost in what you're trying to do on the South Side?
Well, I think what the South Side is trying to do is have balance, and that's where we all get in trouble with in baseball. You know, we get into a situation where power becomes something that we're being successful with, then we go over with power and we don't have any running. Or we get into a situation where speed, you know, the Royals in the 85 and before that were such a speed-oriented team, and we had a big ballpark, and we always felt like we lacked a little power. So every team's trying to create the balance that gets them going, and I think that once we get back to having some speed in our lineup with the power we have, that's going to be a super strong lineup.
We just mentioned the Central. I think the Central division moving forward, I think it's kind of one of the under-the-radar pretty good divisions here for the next 5 years.
I would agree.
I would have to agree with that. Carl Carswell has been our guest here. He's the director of the Get Hits for Education All-Star Game here, also a scout for the Chicago White Sox. Carl, it's been a real pleasure talking to you. Anytime I'm around broadcasting a game, you're around, I'd like to talk to you, and really enjoyed our time here, and thanks for having us out here with 810WHB TV to broadcast the game tonight. We look forward to doing a whole lot more of them.
Thank you so much. I look forward to it as well.
All right, we'll take a quick break. We'll be back to wrap things up next right here on 810WHB-TV.
Thanks a lot, man.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
All right.
So you're behind the barnstormers, you said.
Yes, sir.
Tanner Baker from Midville, you remember Tanner?
Yeah, I do remember Tanner. Yeah,
his dad and my are really good friends.
Oh, nice.
That's where I live. So,
okay.
I knew I knew your game name
yeah,
from somewhere.
I was going to go,
and then you said barnstormers. That's what made it click with me.
I was listening to my recorded sportscast about 12:30 here yesterday, recorded about 2 in the morning. Had the Chillicothe Cameron score on there. Was it 17-14?
Yeah.
I get on there for whatever reason. I go, I'm fine. Guys hit the scoreboard.
Fantasy football show.
Thanks a lot, Carl. Really appreciate it. Take care. Pleasure meeting
you guys. Thank you so much.
Have a good time.
Yep. And I blurted out in the middle of nowhere, final score, Chillicothe 14, Cameron 7.
Yeah, there's stuff you can swear you never said it too about half the time.
Well, see, and what I can't get anybody at the station to realize, and I've been trying to preach this throughout the last 5 years, if you screw up, just keep going.
Right.
Everybody we have there is, oh, I'm sorry, we have, they stumble over themselves, make themselves sound like an ass or something here. First rule of radio, if you screw up, keep going. Unless it's important enough that you have to correct yourself.
I love people that apologize for themselves on their
own. Oh, gosh.
Let's scoot back a little bit more so you're in the camera.
Okay.
Not away.
No, that wasn't.
So, you guys ready?
Yep.
Sure, whatever.
Don't ever say that the level of high school baseball here in Missouri, Kansas, Iowa, Arkansas, Oklahoma, Nebraska, all the Midwest, might not be at the level of those in the Southeast U.S. because of weather conditions and different factors, but We saw some pretty good level of baseball here and a lot of kids that are going to end up getting drafted probably next year in the 2014 first-year player draft by Major League Baseball teams. There's a lot of rounds, so they're looking for a lot of players, and we saw some good ones tonight, Rod.
Oh, we definitely did. I really enjoyed talking to Carl Carswell right there. I tell you what, it's obvious why he does what he does for a living. That guy is one sharp individual. We talk about Get Hits for Education. He's a guy obviously very well educated as we talk to him, and like you mentioned, the talent around in this area, it may get overlooked by the Floridas or the Californias and places like that. But for kids here, for the most part, these kids, you know, not able to play baseball 12 months a year. There's a few that might, you know, sneak out west or down south or somewhere and play some play at times 12 months a year. But for what we're able to deal with because of the weather and things like that, they still put out a ton of talent around this area. And the caliber of coaching, it's exceptional here.
Well, it's going to be interesting over the next few years. And I know he wasn't here tonight because he's working on his own minor league game. But you're going to have to kick in my memory of the young man who got drafted by the Royals out of Gardner-Edgerton. And I should know that.
That would be Bubba Starling.
You got that right. People in Kansas City right now that are watching are saying, who is this idiot? Don't know who Bubba Starling is. But, yeah, great player from Gardner-Edgerton, and he's probably way at the top of the list. But we mentioned earlier the decision that Clayton Custer of Blue Valley Northwest is going to have. Does he want to play baseball? Does he want to play basketball up in Ames for Coach Hoiberg? And, you know, similar situation for Bubba a couple years ago. He had to choose between football for Nebraska, which is pretty high-level football, I might add, and pretty fun, or, you know, baseball and first-round pick of the Royals. And, boy, it's hard to turn down the Royals when you're a Kansas City kid.
Right, and you don't have to get hit as much either.
True. So we saw a lot of hit batters tonight. We got some guys who end up with some bruises in their football teammates. We're going to ask them, I don't remember you getting hit in the hip on the game last Friday. How'd you get that?
Right.
Hitting the hip at the baseball game.
Another great area product. Royals drafted this past year, played Mink League baseball. We talked about earlier for the Chillicothe Mudcats, Brandon Doolin, who's drafted in, I believe, the 12th round by the Royals this year. Had a very impressive Arizona Fall League. Didn't hit 300, but hit real close to it, showed some power. He's a big, strong first baseman, and he's got some speed to go along with it.
I think he was with Mudcats for a cup of coffee.
That That's right.
Drafted and he was gone.
Lee Summit West. No, Lee Summit North, I believe he was out of. Brandon, a Bronco.
Does Lee Summit North actually exist? That doesn't ring a bell. Lee Summit West, Lee Summit, is there a Lee Summit North?
The Broncos would be, I believe it is.
Okay.
All right.
You probably know more of the Kansas City schools than I
yes,
do.
Yes, it would be. It's Lee Summit North.
That wouldn't ring a bell.
Okay. But either way, Brandon, an impressive ball player. I had a good time here tonight. These conditions, I'll broadcast under them anytime.
I broadcast if it's pouring down rain, although we're not going to see a baseball game in pouring down rain.
Right, that's true. Let's hope we don't see that this evening before we get out of here.
I said it's my first time at Community America Ballpark. I came down here for the NASCAR race and saw that in one of the suites here last year from our friends at the Motor Racing Network. I think we have the occasional race on the air, and if I'm not, I apologize ahead of time. But, you know, the Speedway is wonderful. The ballpark is beautiful. I'm going to have to catch a T-Bones game down here, and I'm going to have to at some point catch a sporting game because, you know, if you want to get your money's worth at a major league game in Kansas City, the Chiefs are great, the Royals are great. Your best option might be that Sporting Kansas City team. They rock out 25,000 strong every time they're here.
Yeah, those stay out of the cauldron.
The blue hell.
Yes, that's it. we can talk about the stadium. We don't know much about soccer, but we can talk about the stadium and the atmosphere anyway.
I know this about soccer. If you kick the ball into the net and it's not an offside, you get a point.
Yeah, and they get to go.
That's right. And they throw a lot of blue confetti whenever Sporting scores here across the street.
Right, and I think it's injected a lot of enthusiasm and passion into professional sports here in Kansas City. They do a great job.
Absolutely, and the one thing I do like about Kansas City at the collegiate level, you have the natural Missouri-Kansas rivalry. You don't see it much at the professional level. If you're a Missouri guy and you're a Chiefs fan, you're a Missouri guy and a Chiefs fan, and you can shake the hand of a KU guy who's a Chiefs fan if you're at Arrowhead because you're rooting for the same deal.
That's right. That's right. Well said.
And the Chiefs are 3-0. We haven't talked about the Chiefs all night long, but how about that? Big Red, Andy Reid.
Right. Well, as soon as it was made it clear that he was going to be leaving Philadelphia, I said that's the guy we need. I didn't think we'd ever get him because I thought there would be too many knocking on the door, maybe that he might have liked a little more geographically or whatever. But certainly the support that the fans put behind the Chiefs, the class of the organization, playing in Arrowhead Stadium, all things that helped lure Coach Reid here.
I've been one to say, too, more often than not, that coaching doesn't matter at some point. It's about the players that you have. And obviously you need talent. Any coach would tell you that. But situation like Kansas City where they had talented players that just for some reason they didn't click last year. That is the one situation where I look at it and say, yeah, a good head coach who knows what he's doing would make a ton of good with the Chiefs, and obviously that's been the case.
Absolutely. That's Tom Johnson. I'm Rod Tompkins. Jim Bly has been our producer slash manager at 810 WHB-TV. Also hooked up all the equipment and stuff here this evening. It probably only took him about 7 or 8 hours with everything we got out here.
With us coming through traffic, too, he's probably freaking out by the time 4:30 rolled around, and we were texting him and saying where we are, and got here, though.
Got here, got it on the air. Hey, Tom, really enjoyed the broadcast tonight. Thanks a lot for being along here this evening. Again, I'm Rod Tompkins. That's Tom Johnson. That's going to wrap things up from Community America Ballpark here on 810 WHB-TV.
Final score is 6-5 tonight. Want to add that as well. Team Columbia beat Team Navy on a game that was more important for what you showed to the scouts than the final score, but officially the final score goes 6-5, so we had a close ball game. Really a ball game that was a little bit error-heavy, a little bit wild pitch-heavy, but a good show put on by some good athletes in the 16, 17, 18-year-old range.
Absolutely. Well said. And I'm going to be checking your scorebook since we got the final score in there. I'm going to go check back and check and see what kind of details we find in your scorebook.
Which is kind of non-existent at this point. Community America Ballpark in Kansas City, Kansas. For Rod Tompkins and Jim Bly, this is Tom Johnson. Good night. You've been listening to All-Star Baseball on 810WHBTV.com.
Yep, thank you.
Here goes the baseball. Yeah. He kind of reminds me of a younger Bob Frederick. Not Bob Frederick, that's the old KU guy. He's the guy who runs the Negro League.
Oh, Bob Kendrick.
Yeah.
He's a doctor.
Yeah.
I knew him from somewhere. I finally eventually figured it out.
You're sitting there with that damn camera on, you're sitting there having to, you know, grab something out of my lane. That'd be embarrassing.
You wouldn't be the first guy to do something like that. I have that on YouTube later. And
hell, Chase Daniel still gets grief for that 7 years after the fact.
All right. his girlfriend or wife probably now is from Richmond.
Yeah, she's a TV anchor in Topeka.
Is she? She's from Richmond.
Is she?
Yeah, or she was the last thing I knew.
I bet she's hot as hell.
Yeah. Yeah, probably so. Chase, not quite as bad as he used to be.
Pretty sad, though, the amount of KU people that don't want to root for me, though he's with the Chiefs. You're like, you know what? I'd root for him.
Well, the chances of that happening are
nil. Exactly. You know what I'm saying, though.
Right, of course. Well, I got to be in Knoxville, Iowa. So I'm getting unhooked. You too, brother. There you go.
I tell you what, we got that tie line in. Bebop and Dave had it up in Princeton for Clam DeJanga. He's going to coach us.